Hello, gamers! You're listening to the Short Pause Gaming Podcast. This is episode number 84. Elsie's not here. And welcome to yet another Brent Fussingless Short Pause Gaming Podcast. Here with the Bentastic Duo, Mr. Bender Holtz and Benjamin Boyce. How you guys doing?
Good, man. Good.
Bentastic.
Yeah.
Yeah. We've coined a new verb. I like it.
I approve. So what's been happening? You guys playing some Destiny?
A little bit. Yeah.
Been jumping in there a little bit.
How's the Moments of Triumph going?
It's going.
I think it's actually going pretty well. Wouldn't you say,
yeah.
Bender?
Yeah, it's better than I expected, honestly, because especially with the Crucible stuff, I was really dreading that. But going in there with a friend, it made it a lot easier and a lot more bearable. And now I think we've both finished it, right? We both finished, or you're close to finishing it, right?
Yeah, I'm right at the end. I got a couple more points to get from the mountaintop. You finished the Crucible quest the other day, which is one of the big things in the Moments of Triumph is finishing that Crucible stuff. So that's huge, man, to get that out of the way. And the light at the end of the tunnel, it's in front of us, Bender.
Yeah.
Get a couple things to do with the raid, a couple things with the Prison of Elders, a couple of fragments to grab here and there, and then that's it, man. The Moments of Triumph will be ours.
Yes.
It's exciting.
It'll be awesome.
I guess see Moudini finishes.
We did.
Yeah.
Good job, Moody. Yeah. Knocked it out. Banged it out.
I'll have to work on Flawless Raider soon. Do you guys want to do that before or after?
After.
Do the Moments of Triumph. Okay.
Well, yeah, just because we have limited time to get Moments of Triumph done.
Yeah.
So I'm still a little worried that somehow they're going to like make it... change the raid or something, or make it. I guess they're not going to do it this time, but I'm worried at some point they're going to increase the difficulty of the raid or something and make it impossible for us to get it or something. I don't know. Just my own paranoia.
Have they done that before?
No.
No. Yeah, I think that ship has sailed, Bender. I don't think they're going back to Crota or the Vault of Glass. I think it's a wrap on that.
Yet.
No.
Stop.
You're probably
no,
right.
No.
Yeah. We are, Franklin, probably going to run King's Fall this week, if you're interested.
Go on.
We are, we're going to run some normal runs on King's Fall to build up to a hard run eventually, which is what the Moments of Triumph requires. It requires the completion of Oryx on hard. So we're going to run some normal ones starting this week, hopefully. Obviously, myself and Bender will be involved. Brent will be involved, if you'd like to get involved as well. There's a seat there for you, and then we'll have to fill those other two seats with whoever we can muster up.
Yeah, that's... I would like to play through it. I mean, I'm not going to go and try to do the Moments of Triumph. No. I don't even think it'll be even close, so I'm not gonna try and make a last-ditch effort for it.
Still got, 3 weeks? A little over a month?
Nah. I'm good. I got that emblem from year one, so I'm sad.
you gotta beat Oryx at least once. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, I'd like to see that raid to completion. So
we're gonna get that going.
Awesome. So probably streaming somewhere.
Oh yeah, I'm sure it'll be streaming on one of the streaming services we use. Probably all of them, maybe simultaneously.
Oh yeah. Could be. Oh yeah, because we could do different points of view and stuff.
Yeah, you have something going to Beam, something going to YouTube, something going to Twitch. We'll do them all.
Awesome. Love it. We also got to check out Ernest in Battleborn this week.
Oh, that was so much fun.
That was a great stream.
Yeah.
So those of you who are not following us on YouTube, should go check us out there. We're youtube.com/users/theshortpause. We hopped in a game and had five Ernests, and man, just melted everybody.
he packs a punch, man, that Ernest.
He really does, especially when there's five of you with five like different eggs down.
Yeah.
It's just insanity. So that was a fun stream.
And the egg buffs are all building off each other. So you stand in like you stand in the center of it, and you're like just like Rambo with that egg gun. Things just firing out grenades every 10 grenades a second.
It's pretty amazing.
It's like recharging your health and like increased reload speed.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm, that was great.
And you kill those just like the main villain in one hit with his grenade or whatever they're called, the thrall guys or whatever. Like those guys get killed in one shot. You just mow through them easily.
Mm-hmm. That's all I've gotten up to. I mean, I played through Deus Ex Go. That was pretty cool.
Yeah,
I like those Go games. This one didn't seem to have as much. Like Lara Croft Go has like little treasures you could tap on to collect. Hitman had different approaches you could take to completing each one that gave you different challenges. This one's just kind of get through the map. So it's still a lot of fun. They had a lot of cool things that they had in there for you to figure out. So that was a good time.
Yeah, I've heard some good things about that one. Yeah, a lot of positive feedback on that.
Yeah, I was happy. I actually finished it like the second day with my phone dies really fast now and overheats because of these games. So I try to if I don't finish them within like a day or two, I'm like I don't know if I should keep playing this or not. I don't want my phone to explode. So but yeah, that was really cool. I enjoyed that a lot. So Ben, I got some new releases, huh?
Got a few of them. Got quite a few new releases. So we're gonna jump into this list. This is seriously one of the longest lists I've ever compiled here on this last Tuesday in August. So let's get started right away. Coming to PlayStation this Tuesday for the PS4 is Resident Evil 4. So obviously this is the final part of this like trilogy of remasters that Capcom planned early in the summer. Between Resident Evil 6, Resident Evil 5, and now Resident Evil 4, which many consider to be the best game in the series, many consider to be one of the best games of all time. Funny thing, I've never actually played through Resident Evil 4. I've played it here and there, but I haven't actually sat down, played through the game. So, I feel like I've done myself a disservice by not doing that, and not doing it at this point, because this has been such a seminal game, especially when it first released on the GameCube. So I wish I would have played it at the time so I could have felt the impact that the game had on all the games that came after it and on the series as a whole. So I'm not sure it's going to have the same impact now if I were to go back and play. I'm not sure how well the controls carry over. Like I went back and played Resident Evil 5 with Felsing for a little bit, and the controls felt really old, and it just didn't feel the same as when I originally played that game. So I'm not sure if Resident Evil 4 is going to suffer a similar fate. But from what we've seen of the remaster, it looks like it's coming along well. Looks like it's going to be a good-looking game at the very least. Frankie, you ever played through Resident Evil 4? Is this one of your faves? Is this one that ranks high on your meter?
I'm actually with you. I've played some of it, but I've never sat down and played through it. I had it on the GameCube, but mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure I'm the only person on the planet who had a GameCube that actually died. It was literally like 2 days after I had picked the game up and I went to go play it, and like my disk drive broke. So I maintain that my brother had something to do with it, but can neither confirm nor deny that. So.
Sabotage.
he's a brat. So but. Again, I bought it on the Wii when they did the Wii version. Bought it on the PS3 when it came over there. Just never fired it up. So, I don't know. But much like you, I've played through 5. I haven't gone back to the remaster yet, but I can imagine feeling pretty dated now. Even the Evil Within, though. Like, I feel like playing through that, like a lot of that, I've been told, and I even figured while I was playing it, like there's a lot of elements that are borrowed from Resident Evil 4, so... I don't know. I mean, I'm excited to play it, though. I know it's a longer Resident Evil game, so I'm going to try to find time for it somewhere, but mm-hmm. I feel ashamed that I never played that game.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely one of my shames. I haven't had a chance to go through Resident Evil, so I need to remedy that at some point. Like you, I have it on several systems. I've just never sat down to play through it. Maybe now that's coming to PS4, I'll get around to it, maybe. We'll see. There's tons of stuff going on right now, so... But... you've got a few weeks before the rush of the fall really, really kicks in here. So not a bad time to fire up Resident Evil if you're looking to get through that game. So Resident Evil 4 will be out this Tuesday. I think it's be 1080p, 60 frames across the board here. Set that should be make it a nice looking game. Resident Evil 5 worked really great from what I played on the PS4. The 1080p, 60 frames was great. So I'd imagine this will be similar. Mm-hmm. Let's move on with this list, fellas. We got God Eater 2 Rage Burst also coming to the PlayStation 4 this week. This is the cool thing about Rage Burst is if you grab the day one edition, you're also going to get a copy of God Eater Resurrection, which is the first game in the series, which came out digitally about 6 weeks ago or so on the or maybe 2 months on the PlayStation 4. So this is one of those Monster Hunter kind of games. Brent's played it a little bit, or played it a lot of bit. He really likes it. It's something I've been waiting to get into. When I heard that the original game was going to be included with the second game, I figured, well, we might as well just wait for this one to come out and get it all in one package. So this is a nice little deal here. It's also going to be on the Vita. It's not a cross-buy title, but both the first and second games are available on the Vita as well if you want to get your Monster Hunter fix on the go. But, yeah, it's a cool-looking game. This is an extremely popular game in Japan. Bender, you got any interest in this at all? Any interest in these Monster Hunter games? I know you played a little bit on the 3DS of the of Monster Hunter 4. Yeah, I know you kind of got your fix on there, but do you have any urge or desire to go back to any of these kind of games?
Possibly. I'd look into it. Brent seemed to like this one, so mm-hmm. Yeah, I might check it out sometime, but I don't know. Monster Hunter is like very, very, very dense. Like there's so much involved in it, and it's very difficult to learn everything, all the nuances to it. So I couldn't really, it didn't really keep my interest too much, but you know, if there's a similar type of game that doesn't have all of those systems, that it might be more, a little bit more appealing to me, but I don't know. Yeah. It kind of depends, I guess.
Yeah, no, I hear you. And yeah, these games are renowned for their denseness. I'm not sure about God Eater, how dense it gets in terms or in comparison to Monster Hunter. But, you know, I know people love this game in Japan, definitely. It's got starting to get a following over here as well. But that'll be out this Tuesday. Frankie, where do you stand currently on these Monster Hunter games? Is this something that does anything for you?
They interest me, but like Bender said, there's just so much to them that I kind of shy away from them.
Mm-hmm.
Like I'm picking this one up. This is one, like you, I'd decided to wait on this to get both. For the price of one, because why not?
Yeah, makes sense. But,
yeah, I'm going to try to find time to at least check it out, dabble with it, see if maybe this one's a little more friendly to someone like me who doesn't really want to, you know, invest the time in, you know, crafting all this stuff or going out hunting for different things. Or
yeah.
But I like games that you just fight giant monsters, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's a super cool looking game. It looks great. Looks like it's going to be a lot of fun. Really interested in this one on the Vita, too. You know, having this big, full, like, Monster Hunter type of experience on there across both titles is pretty cool. And I believe the Vita version's cross-play with the PS4 version, so you can jump on there and play across platforms, which is always awesome. So God Eater 2, get your Monster Hunter fix on Tuesday. Speaking of fighting big monsters, how about Attack on Titan? It's coming out this Tuesday as well. I don't know if you guys have been following this game at all, but this game actually looks really cool, in my opinion. It really takes on the look of the anime. The movement system, inspired by like these grappling hook type items that you have available to you as you're fighting these giants that are attacking the city, looks really awesome. Some of the gameplay I've seen looks like it's a ton of fun. I don't know, either of you guys seen the anime by chance?
No, never actually seen the anime.
Mm-hmm.
But I've heard it's good. It's definitely something I'd be interested in. And looking into, but I've never actually watched it.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely one of the most popular anime of the last, like, 5 years. I mean, it's really took the world by storm when it came out. I believe they're planning a season 2 for the near future now, and that's actually one of the cool things about this game is it kind of goes into the lore a little bit of what they're going to explore with the second season of Attack on Titan, so fans can get in there and kind of get a sneak preview of what's coming up in the future for the series, which is awesome. But the game looks like a lot of fun. It's actually got some good press. A lot of people have liked what they've played of it. So this seems like this might turn out to be one of those cult classic, like niche type games that people get behind. So I'm interested to check this one. It's co-op too. It's like it could be a lot of fun attacking these monsters cooperatively. So I got my eye on this Attack on Titan. I want to check this one out. Also coming this week, Hatsune Miku Project Diva X, the rhythm diva, makes her first appearance on the PlayStation 4 from what I can remember. I think this is her first game on there. She's you know, been across many of the PlayStation platforms and several titles. She's on the Vita a lot, and she'll be making her way over to the PlayStation 4 this Tuesday. So Rhythm fans, check that out. Hardcore racing fans are going to get access to Assetto Corsa, which from what I understand is the most brutally difficult driving sim that there is out there. So if you had trouble with Forza, or you had trouble with Gran Turismo, you're going to have a whole lot of trouble with Assetto Corsa, because it takes it to even another level in terms of its realism and how it handles. So, you know, car fans, definitely check that one out. If you're not into simulation driving, definitely stay away from that one. That will only frustrate you. Also coming this week, Strike Vector EX. Very cool looking mech combat dogfighting game. And then one I'm really interested in, guys, is The Final Station. We talked about this when it was unveiled a few weeks back on the podcast, but this is the game I'm going to fire up for the Indie Spotlight this week, Thursday night, 10 p.m. Eastern, on our Twitch channel, twitch.tv/shortpauselive. But this is a game about basically navigating a train through the end of the world. So you've got you know, these abandoned train stations that you come to over the course of the game. There's two parts to this game. There's one part which is like kind of taking care of your passengers and managing your train. So you've got to, you know, get people food and water and make sure they stay healthy and that kind of stuff. So you've got passengers you need to take care of as you're moving your train to your next destination. And then in between those rides, there's abandoned stations that you're going to have to explore, which have loot and enemies and survivors. So you've got to go through there and kind of, you know, find everybody that you can, find all the loot that you can. That'll allow you to upgrade your gun, get better, you know, resources, better upgrades, that kind of stuff for your character. So it sounds like a really interesting game. It's got this really cool pixel art style, something like Not a Hero, for instance. It looks something similar to that. So I'm really interested to check this one out. Super intrigued by it. I'll be playing this one on Thursday. Frankie, you seen this one at all? Is this one of interest to you?
I did not look at it yet, so I'll be tuning into your stream.
Nice. I'll be playing. I'll see you there.
Yes.
About you, Bender? This one do anything for you?
It looks kind of cool. I'm not watching the trailer right now. Yeah, I'll definitely be interested in tuning into the stream as well to see what it's all about. It looks interesting.
Yeah, very, very interesting, very unique sounding game. So it caught my attention when I read it about a few weeks back. So we'll fire that one up this Thursday if you're interested. If you're curious, come join us. We'll see what it's all about. Also coming this week, fellas, we've got Verdun coming out this Tuesday. It's already out on the PC. It'll be out on the PS4 this week. The Xbox One version, unfortunately, has been delayed for an unknown amount of time. We'll figure out exactly when that comes out at a later date. But this looks to be a more realistic take on the World War One shooter. You know, it's trench warfare. It's a lot of really nitty-gritty stuff developed by M2H and Black Mill Games. So, you know, if you guys are out there into, like, really hardcore, like, war simulation games, this one might be a good antithesis to Battlefield 1, which is going to be a more bombastic take, obviously, on the World War One shooter. So this is a little more down and gritty, if that's your thing. Maybe look into this one on Tuesday. Also coming this week, fellas, we've got Claire Extended Cut, a kind of side-scrolling horror game. Kind of reminds me of that game Home. If you remember, that came out a few weeks back, or few months back on PlayStation platforms. A four-sided fantasy. This is an incredibly interesting looking game. There's a lot of really cool looking indie games this week. It was tough to pick a game for the spotlight. I've had my eye on Final Station for a while. There's a lot of really cool games on this list, though. Four-sided fantasy is one of them. It has echoes of Braid or Portal. It takes this really cool puzzle mechanic of like toggling your screen, so you can actually use the different sides of your screen in order to move to another. It's very difficult to explain, so I'm going to stop trying to explain it because I sound like an idiot here. But you have to watch the video for it. Four-sided fantasy. It's a kickstarted game, and it looks like a really cool game. Well, here's the way they describe it. The twist with four-sided fantasy is that the player has the ability to toggle screen wrap on and off at any time. So each new season of the year brings a new twist to screen wrap. Just as you think you've mastered a screen wrap mechanic, the world will change its rules and present a new way for you to look at the confines of your screen. So it toggles screen wrap on and off, and you kind of use that to solve the puzzles in the game. Very interesting looking mechanic, very cool looking game. I definitely recommend puzzle fans keep their eye on Four-Sided Fantasy. I think that game looks super neat. Another very cool-looking game is Hue, which is being published by the good people at Curve Digital, who always publish fine games, seems. But Hue is another puzzle game that takes advantage of colors. So in order to navigate your way around obstacles, you need to change the color of the background. And that'll allow you to solve the puzzles in the game. It's kind of reminded me, what's that game you played, Bender?
Runbow. Yeah. Looks like they took Runbow, the basic concept, and just turned it into a puzzle game.
Yeah.
So it actually looks really cool.
Yeah. The look on that game is awesome. Just super beautiful looking game. This one is coming to the Vita as well. So it'll be out on the Vita a few weeks later. It's a cross-buy title, so if you pick it up on PS4, you'll be able to grab it on the Vita as well, which is awesome. Also coming this week, Live Lock. Got delayed from its original August 2nd release. It'll be coming out this Tuesday now. This is an Alienation type of twin-stick shooter type of game. So we'll see how this one turns out. Binaries, another really cool-looking puzzle game where you've got to kind of control these two, circles, for lack of a better word. You've got to control these two circles who are on two opposite sides of the screen. You've got to get them from point A to point B simultaneously. Looks like it could be a really cool game as well. Nebulous, another puzzle game coming out this week. You've got to navigate a astronaut from one end of the goal to the other. And I don't know if you guys have seen this one, but One Way Life. This is a really just bizarre but very interesting sounding game. I'm just going to read the description of this game for you guys so you can understand what I'm talking about here. But One Way Life, coming out August 30th, this Tuesday. The water supply has been poisoned, and those affected have 6 hours to live, during which they will hallucinate as they die. You and your brother must choose how to spend what could be the last 6 hours of your life. Do you stay home and try to help your friends, or strike out alone on a desperate search for the cure? So it's a really, really interesting concept here, and if you watch this trailer, I mean, it looks to me like one of those... Like an animation style that MTV would have tried in like the early 90s.
Yeah.
You know? Looks like something they would have experimented with, like during like the Daria, Beavis and Butthead, Eon Flux years. Mm-hmm. This looks like some type of an animation system they may have implemented at that time. So very interesting looking game. It's funny because this originally started out as a cover shooter tactical rhythm battle game with narrative elements, and the developers, I guess it's just a couple guys, eventually decided they were going to break this off into two separate games. So, I'm really intrigued by this one as well. I'm curious to hear more about that. If you play One Way Life, like, let us know what it's all about. Hit us up, podcast@shortpause.com. All right, rest of the releases, guys. Yeah, go ahead, Frankie.
Oh, I was going to say another interesting note for that one. It will be a cross-buy game that is coming to Vita at some point. So.
Yeah, indeed. Good call on that. Forgot all about that. So be on the Vita as well. So if you own it on PS4, you'll have it waiting for you. And a little handheld that could later in the year. Mm-hmm. Finishing off the rest of the releases here, we've got The Witcher 3 Game of the Year Edition coming out this Tuesday. Weird thing about this, it's not compatible with your saves. So that kind of sucks, but also...
It's got a new trophy and achievement list too.
Yeah, new trophy list. So if you've somehow went through... Disc. If you somehow went through and 100% of this game, you can go through and do it again and get a whole new set of trophies. I'd imagine this is a lengthy platinum, if I had to guess.
Oh, God. Oh, hell yeah.
So if you are crazy enough to go through and do that again, more power to you. But the Game of the Year Edition will obviously include the game, all the DLC that's released. Was it Blood and Wine? And what's the other one? Heart something? Whatever it's called.
Driving me nuts.
Yeah. Whatever DLC came out for The Witcher 3, it's included in this edition. I mean, Frankie, there's no way this is on the disc, though, right? I mean, it's just too big to fit on a 50-gig disc, right?
What I'm wondering is, why would they make a new trophy list if you have to download the stuff?
Yeah, I don't know either.
I don't know. I know last time I looked at my Witcher 3 file, it was a size that fits on the disc, but I don't know if I didn't buy the season pass on if the DLCs are separate installs or if they're... baked into title updates like a lot of developers do.
The saga continues. The mystery deepens. Maybe we'll find out on Tuesday. Mm-hmm. So if you fair listeners, if you know what's going on with the Game of the Year Edition, let us know. That way Frankie won't have to shell out $50 if he doesn't need to, right?
I did trade in my original Witcher.
Oh, okay. So never mind. You're going to buy this anyways then.
Yeah. They were paying a lot for it, actually. I was like, $20, huh? All right, well, it's halfway to the new one. Why not?
Why not? Finishing out the PlayStation 4 list, we've got Assault Suit Lanos and Lumo, both coming to retail this week. So a couple of digital titles making their way to store shelves. Armello getting its Usurper's Hero Pack DLC this week. Bender, did you ever play Armello?
Never did. It didn't intrigue
me.
I know
you were interested in it, yeah.
I was interested in when it first came out. I just never got around to it.
Gotcha. So I think it's got a few DLC packs since it came out. This is the latest one, adding some new characters, some new arenas as well, or whatever they're called in this game. So look out for that this Tuesday. Fallout 4, the Nuka World DLC, the final DLC pack for Fallout 4, will be out this Tuesday. Let's hope the hell that it works on the PlayStation 4. And then, fellas, Battlefield 1, the open beta starts this Wednesday. This one kind of crept up on me. I didn't realize this was coming so soon. If you're in the Battlefield Insider program, I think you might be able to hop in here a day early, depending on when they send these codes out. So we'll have to wait and see on that. But the beta, two modes, Conquest and Rush, two classic Battlefield modes. Conquest, the big 64-player mode, which is pretty cool. That's going to be available here. And then this will all be taking place on the Sinai Desert map. So this map looks sweet. I don't know if you guys have watched these trailers, but this game just looks incredible. I mean, riding through on horseback, the armored train that rolls through this map in the middle of the match, the armored tank. Hey, this looks like a super cool game. Frankie, I was talking to you about this before the show, but I'm really amped for Battlefield 1. I just think this looks like it just looks like an awesome game, man. I'm really interested to get in, check out the beta, get the first taste of it. But I'm pretty excited for Battlefield 1 at the end of October.
Yeah, same here. I didn't watch the trailer. I mean, I've seen a couple of those. Yep, they've been putting like these little clips on Twitter that you scroll past and they'll start playing.
Yeah, yeah.
So I've seen a couple of those, and that game, you're not joking. That looks intense. Mm-hmm. So I'm really excited to see what that armored train and the horseback stuff is.
Yeah,
it was cool because like there was like a sandstorm.
Yeah.
And like a plane crash. I'm just like, man.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff going on, and I guess these like big huge, like the Zeppelin or the train, you can get multiple dudes in there piloting this thing and using it. So it seems like it's gonna be a lot of fun, man. So riding through on horses, trying to like drop charges and blow up the vehicles. I mean, it just looks awesome, man. I can't wait to play this. So that'll be out this Wednesday. How long does this run? Do you know? What's the end date on this? Okay. So not sure of the end date on it. We'll have to wait and see on that, but really pumped. You start firing that up this Wednesday. That's PlayStation 4, fellas. PS3 this week is getting Attack on Titan. So be on the lookout for that if you're a PlayStation 3 holdout. On the Vita, quite a few titles coming their way this week. Attack on Titan will be on there as well, which is pretty sweet. Alongside God Eater 2 Rage Burst, like we talked about. Hatsune Miku Project Diva X will be on there, alongside Claire Extended Cut, which is cross-buy with the PS4 version, if you so choose to go that route. And Wander Jar. A Wednesday release is like a kind of an old school turn-based RPG game coming to the Vita this week. So move on to Xbox One, guys. September's games with gold have been revealed. Starting off, we've got Earthlock, Festival of Magic. It'll be available starting September 1st. Available for the entire month for the Xbox One. This is a new game, so it'll be released day and date with games with gold. Assassin's Creed Chronicles China will be out or available September 16th through October 15th, also on the Xbox One. On the 360 side of things, we got the original Forza Horizon available September 1st through the 15th, and Mirror's Edge, the original Mirror's Edge, September 16th through the 30th on the Xbox 360. Frankie, what do you think of this lineup?
I'm pretty excited about it, actually. I picked up Forza Horizon a couple weeks back. It was on sale for like $4 or $5, I think. So it's cool that one's finally going backwards compatible. I actually had a better time playing the first Forza Horizon over the second one. The second one was a little too empty for me, so it'll be nice to go back to that one. I like I said, I enjoyed that one, so go back and get some actual achievements on my account, so that'll be cool. And same with Mirror's Edge. I know it's been backwards compatible for a while, but that's still a pretty pricey game to pick up, so it's a nice one to get for free. I already have Assassin's Creed trying on PlayStation, so
yeah.
Maybe I'll play it. Probably won't.
Yeah. Cool. Bender, you seen this Earthlock game? This Festival of Magic. This is the lone new title in the Games of Gold lineup. It's Looks like a traditional RPG, like a JRPG type of game. It harkens back to some of the older Final Fantasy games or some of the older Square games, along those lines.
No, I have not seen this game, but it looks pretty cool. I mean, or sounds pretty cool, rather. I haven't seen it, but yeah, if that's going to be free, then that's awesome.
It's got a really nice art style.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it looks like it might be an interesting title. Mm-hmm. So I'd be interested to hear your guys' thoughts on that. So that's your games with gold lineup. Bender, I know you like Mirror's Edge, too, so it's a mm-hmm. good one to get in the lineup, right?
Yeah, it's a good one.
Set your games with gold for September. We don't know the PlayStation Plus titles yet. Well, those will be revealed this upcoming week, so we'll talk about those next time we chat with you guys. Couple of games that released last week that are available now that we didn't get on the last show. Starhammer, The Vanguard Prophecy is available now alongside the latest hidden object game, Nightmares from the Deep 2, The Siren's Call. Let's pick those up now on the Xbox One. Frankie, I know you've got Nightmares from the Deep 2 in your download queue as we speak, so
can't
wait to get into that one, right?
Love me some Artifacts Mundi garbage.
Speaking of Armello, too, like we did earlier, Armello will be coming to Xbox One this week. So it's been on PlayStation for a few months. I think it's on PC as well, but it'll be on Xbox One now as well, alongside the Usurpers DLC. So go and check that one out. Mahjong, that's the name of the game. So we pretty much know what this one's about. That'll be out this Tuesday, alongside Resident Evil 4, Attack on Titan, and Assetto Corsa. The Turing Test will be out on the Xbox One on Tuesday. Binaries, Hue, The Final Station, Live Lock, those are all coming to Xbox One as well this week. The Witcher 3 Game of the Year Edition will, of course, be on the platform as well. Come on Wednesday, we've got iZombie coming to the Xbox One alongside Hack Slash and Backstab. Interesting sounding game. And on Friday, September 2nd, you guys will have access to Freeze Me and Stories of Bethem, which is another cool old-school RPG-looking title. On the as far as the other stuff coming to the Xbox this week, Fallout 4 Nuka World, that DLC will, of course, be available, and the Battlefield 1 Open Beta will start Wednesday, August 31st as well. All right, fellas, let's get into Nintendo. What we missed last week on the Wii U, Super Mario 64 DS, cool game. Grab that for $9.99 if you haven't. And Shadow Archer, available now on the eShop for $2.99. This week, the Wii U will finally get their hands on Axiom Verge. It's coming out Thursday, September 1st, 1999. This is an awesome game. We've talked about it on the show before. But if you are at all a fan of Metroidvania games, this game heavily inspired by Metroid. If you're at all a fan of that genre, pick this game up. It's well worth it. The soundtrack is incredible to this game. It's a lengthy game. It's a challenging game. It's a very good representation of the Metroidvania genre. I highly recommend Axiom Verge. And good luck wrapping your head around the story and what goes on in that game. It's pretty trippy. Ben, did you ever play through Axiom Verge?
No, never played through. I mean, I beat the first two bosses. I think is about as far as I got, and that was about it. I need to get back to it. It was a cool game though, from what I played.
Yeah, it's a really good game. I think you dig it the more and more you get through it. You know, it's like I said, it's very heavily influenced by Metroid. It's got a lot of that DNA in it, so it's cool that Axiom Verge will be available on a Nintendo platform. Now, obviously, heavily inspired by Metroid. Frankie, what do you think about Axiom Verge, man?
I've yet to play it, but
you bad man. Soundtrack.
I know.
Yeah, no, it's an awesome soundtrack. It's this really cool mix of like chiptune and like dark ominous synth and techno. It's a very awesome soundtrack. And this entire game created by one man, Thomas Happ. From the soundtrack to the creatures to the writing, everything made by this one dude. And basically in his spare time, he cranked this game out over the course of like five or 6 years or however long it took. So it's an incredible feat. Really cool game. Highly recommend Axiom Verge. Please check that out if you're a Wii U fan and you have not played it on another platform yet. I'm sure off-TV play on the gamepad is going to be awesome for that game as well. So $20, grab it this Thursday. Now, the rest of the stuff coming to the Wii U this week. Hold your breath, fellas. This is quite the list here. Piano Teacher, Thursday, $39.99 on the eShop. That is a pricey title, my gosh. The First Skunk Bundle, that's literally the name of this game. $24.99. It bundles several games, which the sum of which does not look like it equals $24.99. But Skunk Software, putting out 5 full-featured video games, including Haunted Hotel, Snake Classic, Catchy, Bomb Blaster, and Zombie Epic. Cool. Also coming to the Wii U this week, Talomir, $4.99. It'll be on the eShop when it releases. Superhero Math, which has an incredible trailer that I recommend checking out for $7.99. I mean, literally, this trailer is incredible. And just, you gotta tune in to the very end as well. The ending's the best part. So, do yourself a favor. Track down Superhero Math and watch the trailer on the on Nintendo's website. That'll be out for $7.99. Skunky Bees, Super Slot Saga number 1. $14.95 on the eShop this Thursday. Panda Love, it's a $1.49 title. Games for Toddlers for $3.99. Free Ballin' for $9.99. Something Bender does in his spare time. Alice in Wonderland, that's a $5 title. And finally, 140 will be on the eShop this Thursday for $7.99. It's a lengthy list of Wii U games. Definitely the most Wii U games we've ever talked about on the new release list. So, yay. For the 3DS, what we missed last week, a trio of Street Fighter games are now available via the SNES Virtual Console, $7.99 a piece on the eShop now. These are all great games. Super Street Fighter 2, Street Fighter 2 Turbo, and Street Fighter Alpha 2. All available now for fighting game fans. How's the D-pad on the 3DS?
It's good. It's just, right. It's the classic type of D-pad.
Classic D-pad?
Know, yeah.
Okay.
It's pretty good.
Should be sufficient for Street Fighter games then?
I would think so.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so as long as the D-pad's cool, then these are definitely worth a pickup. These are all great games, playing these on the go. These virtual console games, they don't have any network features, do they? Like, you wouldn't be able to play against somebody in Street Fighter, would you? Okay.
No, not if the original game didn't have any, then no.
Yeah, gotcha. Now, I didn't even realize that Street Fighter Alpha 2 was on the Super Nintendo. I remember it being on PlayStation, but I didn't realize that it had come out on the Super Nintendo as well. Do you remember that, Frankie?
Nope.
Remember Alpha 2 coming to Super Nintendo? Yeah, I didn't either until I saw this release, and I looked it up, and I was like, well, I'll be damned. It did come out on there. Yeah, Street Fighter Alpha is a great, great game. One of my favorite Street Fighter series of all time. I love that game. As far as what's coming to the 3DS this week, we've got Ping Pong Trick Shot for $1.99 and Adventure Labyrinth Story, an RPG roguelike for $5. Whew, made it to the end of that, fellas. That's the very, very long new release list this week. No, like, big standout retail titles, but there's a lot of niche, a lot of quirky games, a lot of great indie games on the docket for this week, I think, that are worth checking out. So I'm excited to get in there and try out a few games this Tuesday.
Yeah, I can't wait for Bender's stream of Superhero Math. That'd
yeah. Great. Oh, dude, I'm definitely tuning in for that.
Absolutely. So last week, probably about the day after you guys recorded, we had an interesting picture hit the internet of...
probably not even a day. It's probably like 12 hours.
Yeah, we apparently the PlayStation 4 Slim, is there's pictures floating around out there on the internet. Boys?
Yeah.
Dig into this thing, man.
My favorite part was when Eurogamer... here's the story here, so... Apparently, there's a UK, like, eBay type of site called Gumtree, where people put stuff up for auction. And apparently, somebody got their hands on a PlayStation 4 Slim, I mean, box and everything, brand new console, and somebody bought it, you know, off of this guy on Gumtree, and he's been kind of reporting out, and sending out pictures, and kind of reporting on the system up to this point. So, Eurogamer actually got a hold of this guy. They went over to his house. And they booted up the system and took a video of it. So this thing's about as real as it can be at this point. They've since had to take the video down because of, you know, legal reasons or whatever. So the video's not up anymore, but I did see it at the time. I saw the system boot up, so I'm pretty sure that this thing's a reality. I'm pretty sure that this thing will be formally announced at the PlayStation meeting on September 7th. And, you know, I mean... The thing with this system is, you know, in my opinion, the PlayStation 4 is one of the great, like, design feats in terms of consoles that we've had so far. I mean, it's a beautiful system. It was already small and slim to begin with, so there wasn't much you could do with a PlayStation 4 Slim. You know, it makes sense for the Xbox going from the big box down to the slim box that it is now. I think that makes a whole lot of sense. with the PlayStation 4 Slim, from what we've seen here, it's not much slimmer, not much smaller. Can't really get much smaller than the PlayStation 4 as it currently stands. So, you know, this one's a little more rounded. It's got a matte finish, takes off some of the glossy things that the original PlayStation 4 model had on it. So, mm-hmm. You know, it looks like it's going to be fine, though. It's not much different in terms of size, but I'm sure they've, you know, taken care of some of the, just by shaving off that little bit, it'll help with the manufacturing costs on the unit. So,
cool.
Yeah, apparently they also pulled out the optical audio port.
Yeah.
So, interesting, but
not a big deal. I mean, yeah. Pretty much everybody uses HDMI now, so I don't know too many people that are going to be heard over the optical out. I mean, if that saves money in the long run, you know, so be it. Some of the other things they mentioned out here, like there's no mention of 4K playback or anything like that, like we see with the Xbox One S. So wouldn't anticipate that being in the box here. The hard drive's been moved. It was originally on, you know, it had like a bay on top of the system there. But now that the system has slimmed down, they've relocated the hard drive, it appears. It's about 15% smaller than the current PlayStation 4 from what we can tell. The power supply still inside of the unit, so it hasn't moved outside even with the slimmer design. It appears to have a 500 gigabyte hard drive as the standard. You know, from what we can see by the box here, it's in a 500 gigabyte box. Whether or not they'll have higher hard drives or models available, we're not sure yet. The power and eject buttons are physical buttons, not the touch buttons like they are currently on the system. And like you mentioned, Frankie, no optical out. So those are the differences as far as we can tell at this point between the Slim and the current model.
I like the physical power and eject buttons because when I first got my PS4, I could not figure out how to turn it on. I had to look in the manual because I did not know that little slim, tiny little thing that looks like a part of the frame of the system is the button. I could not find it. And it's like the tiniest little power icon on it too. And I was like, I couldn't figure it out. I felt so stupid. But it's nice that they're going to have an actual button this time.
Dude, I still, like, if I'm going to eject a disc, I still hit either the power button or, you know, if I'm trying to turn it on, I hit the eject button all the time.
Yeah.
It drives me crazy.
I do that, too. I've gotten to the point where I don't hit the eject button anymore. I click on, with you know, the options the button controller. and click remove disc or whatever.
So I started doing too.
Yeah. Because, like, I always forget which one is the power and which one's eject. I have to, like, crouch down and, like, look at my console to see it. So I don't bother with that anymore. I just use the controller.
So Bender's excited about buttons. Yay, buttons.
It was just a funny story when I first got my PS4.
Yeah.
Remember Frankie? The Kevin Butler commercial where he's talking about the Move controller and he's like, here's a great feature, buttons. Apparently people like those.
Kevin Butler was awesome.
I miss Kevin Butler.
Yeah, he's one of the greatest commercial runs of all time. Kevin Butler PlayStation commercials were phenomenal.
Mm-hmm.
Frankie, one of the interesting things about when the Slim was released, or some people were complaining about the design of it or like the way it looked. Some people made a big deal about it, which I was like, okay, why? I didn't really get it. I mean, what do you think, man? Some people were complaining that it's not as attractive as the current PlayStation 4, which once again, the current PlayStation 4, one of the great design feats in modern console gaming. It's a slick looking system. It's hard to make something that looks better than that. So by default, whatever they come out with is probably going to pale in comparison. And as they usually do with these slim models, you know, they cut down on the manufacturing costs. I mean, they cut down on some of the glossy stuff, just a matte finish, just basically a rounded square is what the system looks like now. But I don't know, what do you think that, man? What do you think about people making a big deal about the way this thing looks?
You know, everyone just loves to complain about something. Yeah. You know, the bottom line is the whole point of this is obviously going to be to offer a cheaper PlayStation 4. And it looks like it's going to be a cheaper PlayStation 4. Mm-hmm. I mean, me personally, like when the PlayStation 3, the first Slim was announced, like I saw that and I, that's a downgrade from the fat old one. But, you know, as time has gone on, just like that system ran more efficiently. It was a lot quieter. Mm-hmm. And just like over time, like there's just it, like the new design kind of starts to wear on you.
That's the one I still got under my TV over here, that second PS3.
That was a great one. And I saw this and sure. I mean, it looks like, you know, it looks like a cheaper PlayStation 4, and I don't think it's that bad looking. It looks fine to me, but you know, hey, yeah. People need something to complain about, you know. How could you put a new console out anything without people having to complain?
And you know what? We're basically looking at this off of like crappy like cell phone pictures. I mean, we haven't seen like any official images of this thing. So we're looking at these low res shots that people have taken inside of their home or on auctions and that kind of stuff is all we have to go off of. The one like professional shot we have is from Eurogamer, and that makes the console look really cool. So if, you know, if more of those come out, people are going to start to see those and be like, oh yeah, it does look kind of cool. So. But no, you mentioned the thing about like running cool and quiet, and that's one of the things the guy who has this system said. He mentioned that this runs even quieter and cooler than the current PlayStation 4, which is cool.
That's good. That's my usual like main reason to consider one of these things. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not gonna run out and pick up a PlayStation. I don't need a slim PlayStation 4.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I think it looks totally fine.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, it just looks like an external hard drive, just slightly bigger.
Yeah, and at the end of the day, this thing is just sitting under your TV. I mean, who really cares what it looks like? I mean, it doesn't really matter.
It's a cheap entry to play awesome games.
So what do you think the price on this thing is going to be? I mean, if the current PlayStation, like what is the actual base model price of it? Is it $349 or $299? Yeah. All right, $349. So personally, I think the Slim is going to come out at $299. Some people have thought maybe they'd go down to $249. I personally don't see that. I don't know what you guys think.
I can see him going down to $249.
Really?
Yeah. Coming lower than the brand new Xbox. You got less features, so it's hard for them to kind of go out and say, well, you know, here's our Slim. It doesn't have a UHD player, so it's $50 less.
I mean, I just don't really see PlayStation caring much about that. I mean, that's... You know, it's got some game applications in terms of that, but for the most part, that's more of like a movie thing.
Oh, yeah.
So I think them just coming out, hey, our base system is $299 now. You know, it's still the same powerful system that it was before. It's still got the same great library as before. Now you can get into it for $299. I think that's really all they need to do. I don't see them going down to $249.
Bender, where are you at on price?
I don't know. I could see them going... I don't know, maybe $249 because depending on manufacturing costs and if they're not like taking a loss or something, they're still in a good position to sell lots of consoles. So even with the new Xbox that's come in, if they kind of undercut them a little bit, and that could kind of keep their stronghold on the market. So they may do that. I don't know.
Yeah, that's going to be one of the interesting things about the PlayStation meeting is finding out the price difference between the Slim and between the Neo and how much of a gulf there's going to be between them. So, I mean, do you guys think like $100 price difference is enough of a gap between the two models, or do you think it needs to be even greater? Like if they had like a $299 base PS3 and a $399 Neo model, is that enough of a difference to differentiate the systems between one another?
I think so.
I think it's just going to kind of come down to what exactly we hear about the Neo. Like, I assume that's going to look different than this, right? Like, you're not going to put out the Neo and use the same shell as your Slim.
Probably not. Not if they're going to put, like, different components in it. I'd imagine it may look just similar to the PlayStation 4 we currently have, the Neo model. I'm not sure how much of a design difference they're going to do. I mean, once again, the design of the PlayStation 4 has been lauded for a long time. So, you know, why break something that doesn't need to be fixed, you know? The other thing we heard, fellas, was that the system is rumored to be released on September 14th. This comes via This Gen Gaming. They had a report come out recently where they apparently talked to the person behind the auction, and they've since learned that the system is supposed to officially be out on September 14th. So yeah, they put up a picture of like the text conversation they had with this guy, sending them the pictures, and I mean, this thing looks like legit as all hell. Like, if this is a fake, this is the greatest fake ever ever substantiated in the history of gaming. I mean, they got the box here, they got the packaging, and this looks 99.9% legit. So I think we can put this in the bank, take it home. September 14th, I mean, that sounds about right to me. It feels to me like once we get to this PlayStation meeting, they're going to unveil this thing. It's going to be out soon after that. It'll be getting into people's hands for the holiday season. I still think the Neo is going to be out sometime this year as well. To me, if you're going to announce the system right before the holidays, it makes sense to put the system out so that you know, so that you can take advantage of the holidays. So, I don't know. What do you guys think? September 14th seems logical, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it says worldwide September 14th. I looked that day up. Looks like it's a Wednesday. Now, do systems normally come out on a Wednesday?
I mean, the new One S models came out on a Tuesday.
Yeah, they came out on a Tuesday.
They also had they launched with a Madden bundle. So I assume they're trying to line up with that intentionally.
Yeah. So it could be September 13th. Could be a Tuesday thing. Maybe the 14th is the European date. I don't know. But as of right now, we'll pencil in September 14th as the worldwide release date. The other thing we're hearing about the Slim, fellas, is it could include a slight update to the DualShock 4. I don't know if you guys have checked this out, but one of the interesting things about this is this kind of slit, or this basically this see-through area on the touchpad where the light bar can shine through a little bit into the controller, so you can actually see it from the top of the controller instead of having to look at the front of it. So there's been a few pictures that have come out that people have had this supposed update to the DualShock 4. I guess they've tinkered a little bit with the build quality in terms of the buttons, so that those might be a little bit different on this unit. But for the most part, seems like it's going to be the same type of controller, just with some updates, in a few basic areas. Have you guys seen this controller at all?
No.
No.
Yeah, I'm curious about the light bar on the front of the trackpad thing, how that's going to work, or the touchpad.
What would be the point of that?
I think it's just because how some games they do stuff with the light bar, they'll change colors or whatever, or they'll do different things based on what's happening in the game. Mm-hmm. And right now the only way to see that is to flip your controller over and look at the front of it. So I think it's just to give people that feedback without having to flip their controller over. That would be my guess. That's the only reason why they would do it. So it's a very small, glass window on the top of the touchpad, basically. It's hard to describe, but it's like a slit. But it's like a brief little slit that gets you a window into what color the light bar is or how it's performing at that time. Hmm. So hopefully that's not distracting or anything when you're gaming. I don't imagine it would be, but... So we can look forward to that probably from what we've seen. None of this is confirmed at this point, but it seems like that's what's going to happen with it. A couple of the things, the guy that has the system, he's mentioned through various outlets, but this guy, Shortman82, is his Twitter name. He said that no new features or resolution options could be found in the console, but it also doesn't have the 4.0 software update on there yet. According to Shortman, like we mentioned, the console runs unbelievably cool and quiet. The trigger buttons on the new DualShock 4 feel more solid with better materials. Buttons and sticks are exactly the same height as the original DualShock 4 controller. The additional light bar doesn't actually have a light of its own. It's just a see-through strip on the touchpad that lets the original light shine through. The battery is the same one used in the current DualShock 4. That said, Shortman mentions that he has owned the console for 24 hours, and the controller is still on two bars, which is interesting. So obviously that's one of the big faults of the DualShock 4 is it runs out of battery quickly. You get about 6 hours out of that thing before it needs to be charged again, which, isn't that big of a deal. I mean, unless you go on one of these marathon sessions. but it would be nice to have a longer battery life, so hopefully that's something on the new DualShock 4. Then the controller comes with an option to select the communication method with the PS4 between USB and Bluetooth, which is interesting. This option seems to be available only to the new version of the controller, but it does appear on the original PS4 as well. Frankie, what's the reason you would do that? Is this just to get reduce lag or something like that? Like if you put it on USB, is that why you would do this?
Yeah,
if you're playing a fighting game or something.
Yeah, literally for fighting games. But even still, Yeah, I guess that would actually make sense. If you're plugging it in, it's letting you turn off the Bluetooth signal and just run straight through the wire. That's probably, yeah, you're going to have a lower latency then.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that would make sense for, like, Street Fighter, Mortal Kombat and such.
If they're going to go after all these fighting games and get them on their system, I guess it makes sense to have that option. I mean, I know fighting game fans, they love the to plug in their controllers. So I'm sure they'll be excited by that. So that's basically what we know about the Slim right now. I mean, it's a lot. We know quite a bit about it ahead of the official unveiling of the system here in a few weeks. But one of the main things I wanted to ask you guys about this is, you know, with these redesigns or these console refreshes here, it seems like Sony and Microsoft, they're going in slightly different directions here. Like Microsoft system obviously is a drastic change physically from the original Xbox One. It's much smaller, which you pretty much need it to be. So it's a much sleeker system. It's got the 4K Blu-ray playback with the HDR support. So it's got that stuff going for it. It does, you know, it slightly improves the performance of certain games, but not anything that's really noticeable. So it's a bit of an upgrade in terms of the original model of the system. It's coming out for $299. Sony's putting out a slim version that is basically the same thing as the current system, with the exception of the optical port. So, I mean, Frankie, what do you think about the direction that they're going with these refreshes? Is one better than the other? Is it really just a product of where these two companies are at in their current, like, video game business? What do you think?
The main interesting thing to me, honestly, was the fact that Microsoft decided to put that UHD drive in the Xbox One S. Mm-hmm. That's a thing that Sony has always done. Like, the, you know, if you wanted a DVD player, the PlayStation 2 was your cheapest bet. You know, even getting into Blu-ray, the PlayStation 3 was, you know, the route you wanted to go. So seeing them kind of just take that leap into the UHD and kind of having, like, that cheaper UHD player while being a game console as well. I'm kind of baffled that Sony's not going to do the same thing, but, you know, there again, I mean, that's the thing I'm really concerned about, like, in terms of the Neo, because, you know, like you guys have talked about before, like, these games are not going to be small, you know? Like, you're not talking about a game that's going to come out and just be, like, 20 gigs. Like, these games are going to be, you know, 80, 90, 120 gigs. So, standard Blu-ray disc holds 50. I don't know what a UHD Blu-ray holds. I imagine it's got to be at least twice that, right? I have no idea. I'm still not into this 4K stuff, so I haven't done any research on any of this, but I figured too, like, Microsoft can afford to take a hit if they have to, you know, whereas the PlayStation is kind of buoying Sony along right now, as far as we know. So, you know, I can see them, you know, going, like, a cheaper route to still kind of have either, you know, a cheaper or same price as the Xbox One justifiably for them. So I obviously Sony have to make a little more concessions on Microsoft, but I don't know. It's interesting. I don't necessarily think one's better than the other, though. I think going with the Xbox, they're just kind of, you know, trying to regain some ground, you know, trying to get the tech people who would want, you know, a cheap UHD Blu-ray player. You know, those features are cool for people who have 4K TVs, but I don't, like I said, I haven't looked into any of this, so I don't know, but I can't imagine there's a ton of 4K content around right now, so.
Yeah, my thought on this is the fact that, you basically alluded to it there, but Microsoft, they wanted to do something to kind of, like, kickstart the Xbox brand, you know, get something, like, get people juiced up again. So they get this system that's a drastic redesign from their current model. Like I said, 40% smaller. It's a much smaller, much sleeker unit to get people excited about. They add the HDR support on there, which is going to be, you know, certain games are going to be able to take advantage of it. You're going to be able to, like you mentioned, play the Blu-ray movies that have the HDR support through your system, and it's going to be one of the cheapest options for audio or video files to be able to do that. So I think, you know, just the way that the market was going, you know, this is a good move for Microsoft to do something like that to get people behind, like, this new system. And on the other side of the coin with Sony, I just think that, you know, some of that stuff, some of the features, some of the 4K stuff, like, they want that to be for the Neo. Like, that's going to be that system's thing. If you just want to get into a base PlayStation 4 and just experience the game offerings that Sony has available, like, this is the system you're going to get into. So I think they want to make that clear delineation between this is like your basic PlayStation 4 game machine. This is your Neo, which is going to do all the 4K and that kind of stuff is going to be over here. So some of those features I think we will see in the Neo. And I think just where they are with the amount of systems that they sold and where they're at with their video game business, like this makes sense for Sony to do their kind of just base, real basic entry level model and to have their Neo. And it makes sense for Microsoft to do what they're doing right now to get kind of, more excitement around the Xbox brand. Bender, what do you think, man?
I agree with you guys. I don't know if like each one way is better than the other, but both seem to be pretty solid strategies. I mean, for Microsoft to have a system that's better than the original Xbox is a good thing, and then mm-hmm. Sony for them to have a system that's cheaper than the original system, especially if they do kind of make it a little cheaper than the Xbox One Slim. That'll kind of put them in a good place. But, I don't know. They're both pretty solid strategies, I guess.
Yeah.
The other thing with this was Microsoft's had that stigma around them with, a lot of games, runs on 900, 930, 960 on Xbox, 1080, 60 on PlayStation 4. Like, they have that stigma that they still had to shake, and I think this is kind of helping them get away from that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We'll see how the games turn out. We'll see if I'm not sure if this is going to have any effect on that, if they'll be able to leverage this in any way. But it'll be interesting to see if they're able to tackle any of that kind of stuff in any way. And mm-hmm. I think you guys hit it there. I mean, I don't think one strategy is better than the other. I think this is the strategy Sony needs to employ for their device, and I think that's the strategy that Microsoft needs to employ for their device. I think they're doing the best thing for each of their brands at this current point in time as we sit. So we'll find out more about the Slim and what Sony's plan is with all this come September 7th. But that'd be a hell of a move, though, if they undercut the $299 on the PlayStation 1 to be a drastic price decrease on the PlayStation 4. The Xbox One, yeah. So what'd I say, PlayStation 1?
Yeah.
So, yeah. So, yeah, obviously be a drastic change from that. No, but from the Xbox One, yeah. If they undercut that $299, that'll be a shrewd move. So, if they do that, they're swinging for the jugular, especially with the holidays coming up. If they come out with the $249 system, that's that's gonna move a lot of units. That's it, Frankie. That's it for the Slim.
Nice. Are there of you in the market for a Slim PlayStation 4?
No.
Nah, I'm good with the one I have.
No, Neo will be. Will be the system that I'm in the market for. Yeah. Like I said, the current PlayStation 4 does what it does perfectly fine, and the Neo will be the next one that I grab.
I assume we can expect like the official unveiling of this at their September 7th event.
Definitely.
Dive back into this next time we all gather to talk about video games.
Yeah, man.
So we're going to stick with Sony for a little bit here. Had a couple more stories from them come out this week. PlayStation Now is indeed coming to PC. Pretty sure you guys had talked about this last week, that there was a rumor swirling around that this would happen.
Mm-hmm.
I may have even been here. I don't even remember. It may have been a couple weeks ago. But it's been officially announced. There's a blog post about it and everything. It's going to be a little USB dongle that'll be out in early September for $24.99.
I'm getting that.
Yeah. Play
a I need that. Because I wire up my controller now. Like I have this thing where I can use my PlayStation 4 controller on my PC right now, which is a simple program. But this will be nice to be able to just plug this in and have a wireless connection.
So, will this work for like PC games as well, or is this strictly going to be a PlayStation Now thing?
No, I'd imagine this would work for PC games as well. It'll work for remote play as well, because you can remote play to PC now as well. So be able to. Yeah, so that'll be a nice addition for those folks as well.
Just gonna hit you with the quick minimum specs that they have on here for playing PlayStation Now on your PC. You just need a Windows 7 with Service Pack 1, or Windows 8.1, or Windows 10, a 3.5 gigahertz Intel Core i5, or 3.8 gigahertz AMD A10 or faster, 300 megabytes or more. Well, that doesn't make any sense. 300 megabytes or more, 2 gigabytes or more of RAM.
300 megabytes, I'm guessing, is maybe hard drive space.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So we'll go 300 megabytes of hard drive space, 2 gigabytes or more of RAM, and of course a sound card and a USB port, obviously.
Obviously.
So cool. This is coming out first in Europe and apparently will follow soon after North America.
Yeah, PlayStation Now is already available on PCs in Europe. So they've already started rolling that out. In the U.S., maybe this starts after the PlayStation meeting. Not sure what the plan is over here.
Yeah, I believe that that's probably one of the talking points they wanted to save for that. But
yeah, maybe it'll come alongside that announcement that Brent's been waiting for. That you can play your digital games via PlayStation Now. Probably not, but we'll see.
We can hope, right? Like, I would love to. I have hundreds of games. I'd love to just be able to play on the PS4, but
yeah,
I'm not going to hold my breath.
Me neither.
Continuing on with PlayStation here, the PlayStation Plus membership price is going to be changing in a bad way. for 1 year, it's going up to $59.99. I think that's what Xbox Live costs.
That is correct.
And the 3-month subscription cards are going to be going up to $24.99, which are currently at $17.99. So, these changes will be going into effect on September 22nd. Mm-hmm. So stock up now. Follow Cheap Ass Gamer, some of the game deal Twitter accounts that constantly tweet out deals on this stuff if you're really worried about it. What do you guys think of that?
It's not good to have to pay more, but I mean, if with inflation, it kind of makes sense. I don't know. I'm not sure why they're doing it, but it is what it is. Gonna have to pay it. Can't do much about it.
I mean, personally for me, man, this is not a big deal. Some people really made a big deal about this week, and I was just kind of scratching my head like, okay. I mean, PlayStation Plus has been the same price since it came out in 2010. So for 6 years, it's been $49.99. You know, here we are in 2016. They're raising the price $10 to $59.99. And, you know, like you mentioned, it's the same price as Xbox Live now. I don't know about you guys, but I personally have never paid full price for a PlayStation Plus membership. I've always bought it on sale, on one of these deals that are always, literally every week, there's a deal on PlayStation Plus membership cards. And I don't believe that's going to change now that the price has changed by $10. Mm-hmm. You know, in the grand scheme of things, this is 83 more cents a month to be a PlayStation Plus member. I've always found a lot of value in PlayStation Plus. I love getting the free games. I love getting all the discounts. Obviously, I like being able to play my games online. So, you know, price increases always suck, you know, but it's just part of business. It's part of inflation. It's part of this society, you know, that the prices go up on these things eventually. And we've had PlayStation Plus at a solid price for 6 years. So, you know, I just take that as a win that we had it for as long as we did at $49.99. Now it's the same price as Xbox Live, and to me it's just not a big deal. It's just one of those things, like you said, Bender. It's one of those things we're gonna have to deal with. You know, some people have been asking like, what's gonna change? What are they gonna add? They're not gonna add anything. This is the price of the thing now. This is it. This is part of business. It's unfortunate, but it is what it is, man. It's not a big deal in the grand scheme of things, in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, I was kind of annoyed at first, just because, like, for me, like, I don't get to play games ever, so I was playing Battleborn this week, and, like, the network randomly went down. Like, I don't get on there as often as, you know, a lot of other people do, so I don't know if that's, like, a frequent thing, but if you're up in the cost, you need to, I don't want this, like, random maintenance stuff, and I think Brent mentioned that as well, but outside of that, I mean, like I've said hundreds and hundreds of times, like, the discounts alone have made PlayStation Plus well worth it for me. Mm-hmm. So I'm still going to save more than $10 buying stuff over the next year. So overall, I'm fine with it. I would like to see something like actual, like, cool come out of this. Like, yeah, you know, we've added more servers. You know, we're not going to be doing maintenance as frequently as we do. Like, something like that. That's the least I would expect.
Yeah, I mean that'd be great. If I hope they do something like that. I just I don't know. I feel like they're just probably just gonna raise the price, and that's just gonna be it.
Yeah,
I don't know that they're gonna give us anything or more or talk about anything more as a result of this. They've said the new pricing reflects current market conditions. while enabling us to continue providing exceptional value to our members. And I think they're probably just going to leave it at that. So it'd be nice if they did something like that, like less maintenance updates or that kind of stuff. But I don't know. I don't think it's going to happen.
Yeah. Ben, they added two-step verification, which they is did. Funny because I think you guys mentioned this last week that it's coming at some point, and hey, surprise.
Surprise, it's here.
I tweeted like midnight or something on Tuesday or Wednesday. It was, hey, it's live. So
it was live, Ben, ready to go.
Yeah, you set this up. Walk us through. How does this work?
Yeah, we were talking about this before the show. I can't remember if I did it on my phone. I think I did it through the PlayStation app on my phone or on my laptop. I can't remember anymore. I'm getting old. Things become a blur after a few days. So either I did this via PlayStation.com on my laptop, or I believe I did it through my PlayStation app on my phone. But yeah, I just went in there. There's a I pulled a link up from somewhere where that took me to the two-step verification page. Just go on there. It's a pretty simple process. They're going to send something to your phone, like a code that you have to type in. And then it's going to take you through the process of, you know, setting up your password wherever if you don't already have that. You can set up a password for other PlayStation devices on your account. So anytime somebody does set up a new PlayStation device with your account, they have to type in a specific code that's unique to your account in order for them to set up a system. So that helps with people, you know, it helps with people not being able to just hack into your account via, you know, a new system. So it wasn't really a big deal. It was a couple steps. Didn't take very long. It's kind of annoying at first just because you have to reset up all your PlayStation devices, or at least that's what I did. I reset up all the devices on my account so that, you know, with the two-step verification process. So once you get that out of the way, though, it's pretty straightforward. So I would recommend doing it for that added level of security. It doesn't take very long in the grand scheme of things.
Cool. Ben, are you setting this thing up?
Yeah, I probably will. Just like Ben was saying, for the added security. Couldn't hurt.
Yeah.
I get nervous when you start seeing random, like, hey, I think my credit card information was taken. I'm like, ah. I don't keep mine on there anymore, but I don't know, man.
Yeah. Just for convenience, I buy a lot of stuff on PSN, so I would like to keep my card on there so I don't have to keep inputting it every time. Yeah. So having the two-step verification, it's good for that kind of stuff for sure.
Yeah. I'll get around to it at some point.
But, yeah.
Let's see what else we got here. Apparently PlayStation, Capcom, and Humble Bundle have all grouped up together, and there is a Capcom PlayStation Humble Bundle running now through September 15th. Let's see what we get in here. So the pay what you want tier. So you could just pay what? Is there a minimum? Like, do you really just give them a penny and get these games?
I'm not sure if there's a minimum. If there is a minimum, it's very small. It's like a dollar or something, so.
Okay. All right. Well, let's pretend you want to pay a dollar. You will get Strider. That's on the PS4 or PS3.
A very good game.
Strider is fantastic.
Actually, the last platinum I earned on the PlayStation 4 was Strider.
You're a madman. That game is challenging.
Yeah. I love that game. Good Metroidvania game.
Final Fight Double Impact for the PS3.
Hell yeah. Another good one.
Wolf of the Battlefield Commando 3 for the PS3. I've never heard of this one.
Yeah. It's a Commando game. Very early in the PlayStation 3 life, I believe. I don't even think this had trophies. Oh. I might be mistaken on that.
Super Puzzle Fighter 2 Turbo HD Remix.
An awesome game.
On the PS3.
Yeah.
And a 45% off Street Fighter 5 PlayStation Store coupon, which is valid until October 1st.
Yeah, that's a beefy discount on that game.
Yeah, that's not bad at all.
That's literally for like paying a dollar. You get all that stuff.
Yeah. So I don't know what the average tier is right now. But if you pay above that, you'll also get Resident Evil. That's the remaster, I believe.
Yep.
On the PlayStation 4 or PlayStation 3.
Mm-hmm.
The Mega Man 9 and 10 bundle on the PlayStation 3.
Awesome.
I've heard those are good.
They are.
Okami HD on the PS3.
Ooh. Love Okami.
Yeah.
Another good one. Played that one.
It's so good.
Very, very Zelda-like, right, Bender?
Yeah, it is very Zelda-like.
Nice. Remember Me from Don't Nod mm-hmm. on the PS3. Super Street Fighter 2 Turbo HD Remix.
A fantastic game.
Lost Planet 3, which I have not played, but I've heard good things about.
Mm-hmm. So that's all for the average tier, which usually, whenever I buy a Humble Bundle, I feel like the average tier hovers around like $7, $8.
Mm-hmm.
So for $7 or $8, you get like all 8 or 9 of those games you just mentioned, mm-hmm. which is mm-hmm. pretty crazy. And this money goes to good causes as well.
Yes, which actually I think they'll let you choose. It could either go to charity, yeah. PlayStation, Capcom, Humble
yep. Bundle. You can choose the percentages that you want it to go to different places. It auto picks, like it has a like an automatic percentage that it puts to these different places, but you can adjust that how you want.
Okay. Then lastly here, if you pay $15 or more, you'll also gain these games. The Resident Evil 0 remaster on the PS4 or PS3. The Devil May Cry HD collection on the PlayStation 3. That is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
And a 50% off the Mega Man Legacy collection for the PlayStation Store coupon.
Yes. Also amazing.
That also expires on October 1st. So for $15.
Yeah.
That's an insane amount of games.
Yeah. Yeah, these Humble Bundle. This is the first time I can, at least that I've noticed, that Humble has teamed up with PlayStation.
Mm-hmm.
So that's pretty awesome. Yeah, this is an incredible deal here for $15. And like I said, the money goes to a good cause. If you don't have these games, I mean, it's a no-brainer. Hell, if you don't have like half these games, it's a no-brainer to pay the $15, get everything on this list. You can give out the codes to your friends for the games you already have. I mean, it's an incredible deal.
Yeah. I didn't look at this page, like I said, but do these come with the soundtracks? Because I know a lot of these typically get soundtrack bundles.
I don't believe that this particular bundle has the soundtracks. They've already put quite a few games in here for the 15, okay. So I don't think they've added in the soundtracks. I could be mistaken on that, but as far as I know, there's no soundtracks involved here.
Oh, that's still a great group of games, though. So is it humblebundle.com, I believe?
Yeah, humblebundle.com. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it should just be on their front page. It'll
yeah.
count out timer. So
yeah, their bundles are usually right on the front page there. So
cool. So that is through September 5th. So,
mm-hmm. So after you listen to this show, go buy that.
Yeah. Moving on here. 100-foot robot golf will launch on October 10th. I cannot wait to play this game. they talked a little bit more about the PlayStation VR version. Apparently, you're a guy who's just going to be hanging out on top of these robots. So
why not?
Yeah, basically, right?
That's
cool.
Yes, obviously, this game will be in VR on October 13th. So it'll be out on the 10th, ready for VR once it makes its grand appearance a few days later.
That's awesome. No price yet, unfortunately.
No price yet on Robot Golf.
Looks like a good time, though.
Yeah. Looks to be in that Goat Simulator family of titles. Just the stupid fun games.
Yeah. The kind of stuff I get behind easily. Yeah.
It's a Frankie Ehler game if I've ever seen one.
Ben, there's compelling evidence that Mads Mikkelsen is going to be in Death Stranding.
This is hilarious, man. So, basically, Mads, you know, this is the guy who used Le Chiffre in Casino Royale. He's in Hannibal, you know, one of Brent's favorite shows. So that's what he's known for recently is his role in Hannibal. And apparently, he's one of Kojima's favorite actors. And people think that he's going to be a part of Death Stranding now. And the reason they do is because Kojima tweeted out this picture of... No, it's a studio. They look like they're motion capturing, doing some mocap work. And standing in the background is a blurry picture of this dude with an orange shirt with a gray hood on it. Now, fast forward to a little time later here, a NeoGAF guy came across this Instagram picture of Mads wearing this orange hoodie with a gray hood. And the fact that apparently when this picture was shot, he was in Sheffield, which I believe is in California, to act in a video game, and that it was a Japanese game in particular. And like I said, Kojima has called Mads his favorite actor, And so he's no stranger to these Hollywood guys. And obviously he's teamed up with Norman Reedus. So it wouldn't be out of the realm of possibility that the guy in this picture is Mads and he's getting ready to be in Death Stranding.
Cool.
Awesome.
So I just think it's hilarious how this all came together. It's just like random stuff. Like Kojima tweets out this picture. This guy sees a random Instagram post from this other guy posing with Mads in the same shirt that this supposedly this guy's wearing in this picture. And you know, and they put together this stuff that Kojima likes this guy and he's working on a video game and all this stuff. It's just hilarious how people figure this stuff out.
I love when people piece all this stuff together.
Yeah. Yeah, but that'd be awesome though. If he's in this game, they're assembling quite the cast then for Death Stranding. And that's pretty exciting.
Next thing we got here, Blaze Blue, Central Fiction, had a limited edition announced. This is coming exclusively to the PlayStation 3 and PlayStation 4. PlayStation 3 getting a late November release.
Yeah.
Something cool.
Yeah.
But this edition is going to have a deluxe hardcover art book, which will have 100 pages of Blaze Blue art. A mini Noel Vermilion Nendoroid figure. Nendoroid? What are those things?
I don't know. It's like a chibi type of figure, I guess. I don't know.
I keep seeing those things pop up. Like, I assume they're well made.
Yeah. Where do you find those? GameStop, Amazon? Like, where do you get those Nendoroid?
Said either or.
Mm-hmm.
I think that was a Think Geek thing, which yeah, GameStop I think owns some now. So,
gotcha.
And of course the Interlude 3 soundtrack, which is 10 tracks of in-game goodness.
Of course. So why in the hell would they ever give you the actual soundtrack?
Yeah, that's just insane. Well, this is only $89.99, so I mean, is that it?
So yeah,
that's all. So look for that on PlayStation in late November.
Mm-hmm.
Ben, we got a couple more games on here. Show us through here. We got Don't Starve.
Yeah, Don't Starve Together, coming to PlayStation 4 on September 13th. I'm excited about that one. I think that looks like a good time. Don't Starve is a really cool game. I'm curious to see what that plays like cooperatively. So yeah, go ahead.
Do you know if this is split screen or is this online?
No, this is online. This is online co-op. So, you know what? I believe it actually might have both.
Oh, that'd be wonderful.
Yeah, let me double check.
I get Jen to burn down a forest with me.
Yeah. I know Bender's all about that. Yeah. Don't Starve will support up to 6 players online and for the first time ever support split-screen couch co-op, both locally and online.
Beautiful.
Awesome. They're also coming out with a mega pack version of this game. Mm-hmm. Which is going to have Don't Starve Together, Don't Starve, obviously the main game, Shipwrecked, Reign of the Giants, and the two themes they've come out with for Don't Starve. It'll all be packaged into one pack for $26.99, which is a great price. And if you own the original Don't Starve, you can actually pick up this whole pack for $10.79, which is a steal.
Yeah, which I think is actually cheaper than the expansion itself.
Yeah, so great price for that. Don't Starve is a super cool game. If anybody's interested in playing through Don't Starve Together, give me a heads up, because I really want to play this on co-op, see what it's all about.
I wouldn't be opposed to checking it out. I don't know what I'm doing in that game at all, but I love the look of that game.
Yeah, it's a super cool game. One of the best-looking games out there still, in my opinion, as well. It's just got that really cool Tim Burton pencil hand-drawn art style. So I love that about the game. And the thing with Don't Starve is nobody really knows what they're doing. Like, you get dropped into the game, and there's no prompts. There's nothing. You just got to kind of figure out how to survive. So it's always been interesting in that respect. And I feel like that would be a lot of fun with two people just kind of running around. Like, what the hell are we doing? Yeah, I don't know. Burn that tree down. Let's see what happens. And then you just start causing chaos. So I think that could be really cool. We also got this game, Jazz Punk, fellas. The Director's Cut, coming over to the PlayStation 4 on September 20th. It's already out on the PC. I can't really make heads or tails of this game. It's some type of a comedy first person adventure experience. So let's see what that one's all about. And then
I know that one. There's another one they've talked about a lot on Giant Bomb.
Mm-hmm.
Like won one of their best style awards or something one year. So
yeah. Yes, yeah, so I don't know. The people love this game on the PC, so it must be doing something right. Mm-hmm. So they're adding a few things to it when it comes over to the PlayStation 4 on September 20th. Then we've got Carrare, Magic Library. Hits PlayStation 4 September 6th. This is a free-to-play card battling game. So, be on the lookout for that on September 6th.
Well, we're going to take a quick break here. So, got some music for you from Real Ethan, and we'll be right back. And welcome back, guys. So, gotta talk about the NX.
Yeah, man, the rumor mill continues to churn away with the NX here. So, the latest report we got this past week, the detachable NX controllers will support motion control and force feedback. So, this is a report that comes via Let's Play Video Games, which I believe is a site that was created by a former Destructoid person, maybe? Don't quote me on that, but I think that's right. But here's what Let's Play has to say about this. So, a couple weeks back, Eurogamer reported that the Nintendo NX will be a hybrid device, combining a handheld and a home console with detachable controllers on either side of the handheld. We talked about that in depth a few shows ago. In the past few days, Let's Play Video Games has learned that not only was the Eurogamer report accurate, which we've heard from several sources that that was an accurate report, but the detachable NX controllers will support basic motion control, similar in fidelity to the Wii Remote Plus, in a form of advanced vibration force feedback. Let's Play Video Games has learned that these controllers are designed to phase out the Wii Remote over time, featuring much of their same functionality. Players with existing Wii Remotes will be able to use them for some multiplayer titles, but not for all releases. The force feedback functionality of the controller has been described by one source as very similar to the Vive controller, and that it alters intensity, pulsing patterns, and duration of vibration to mimic the sensation of a range of different movement types. This is one of the cool things that we've heard about the Vive that I've been interested in with that. But it's not just one vibration for all situations. There's a notable difference between the hard, abrupt feedback of a sword clash or the softer, longer thud of something like hitting a tennis ball. One of the titles that will support the new NX detachable motion controllers and Wii Remotes for multiplayer is Just Dance 2017. We have learned since its announcement at E3 2016 that the title is planned to launch alongside the console on day one. The Let's Play report is based on two independent sources, one of whom acted as a source when Until Dawn Rush of Blood leaked 1 week ahead of its announcement last year. So fellas, we've got another report now. That this NX is is supporting motion control and force feedback. Bender, what do you think about that, man? To me, I feel like with the NX, and I thought with the NX, what we were going to do was move away from the Wii. Like, we were going to get away from that brand, like get away from the Wii and just get a fresh start with the NX. Now, from this report, it sounds like not only, you know, will the breakaway controllers feature motion controls, but it'll actually work with Wii remotes as well, which I thought was the strangest part of this report. Obviously, yeah. None of this is confirmed at this point. This is all just rumors and things that people have heard from their sources. But what do you think about that, man? This seems like an odd move on Nintendo's part to bring the Wii back into the picture with motion controls.
Yeah, it does. I mean, I hope that if it is capable of motion control, that's fine. I just hope they don't put a heavy emphasis on that. Mm-hmm. I mean, I hadn't considered them being similar to Wii remotes before, but in one respect, that does seem like a good thing, because, you know, when you hold the Wii remote sideways, it works basically like an original NES controller. It's got the two buttons and the D-pad, and it works quite well for that. So if it's something like that, that's fine. I mean, that'll be cool for games if it's a game that doesn't require a lot of buttons. Mm-hmm. But I just hope they don't do a heavy emphasis on the motion control stuff, especially if it's going to be a portable thing. I don't want to be like waving my portable gaming system around. I really hate it when the 3DS has any sort of motion control thing, or where you have to move to aim or anything like that. It doesn't work for a portable system. You end up looking dumb. You know, you can't be sitting there on the bus or at your lunch break at work, like moving your system every which way to play a game. It just doesn't work that well. So I hope they don't put a heavy emphasis on that, but you know, I guess we'll have to wait and see.
Mm-hmm. Frankie, one of the things we've heard postulated about this is that maybe this is, like Bender alluded to there, maybe this is something where they can break it off and use this as a Nintendo remote, or it's something that you can use to play backwards compatible Wii games, or, you know, something like that. You know, we don't know what the backwards compatibility situation is going to be with this system. To me, that's a cool idea if it works in that respect, but they got to kind of get away from the stuff they were doing with the Wii, right?
Yeah, and I mean, I'm pretty sure they've said we're trying to get away from the Wii. Like, this is not going to be the Wii. So, I mean, maybe, like, to the degree of what motion controls are for it, maybe aren't as, like, nefarious as the Wii. You're not going to have games like Wii Sports that have all the Wii Waggle and whatnot. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe it's going to be more similar to, like, the PlayStation motion controls, where it's, like, a six-axis thing. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, I'd be kind of interested to see what they end up doing with it, so... I'm just, I guess, like you, I'm hoping it doesn't become another Wii thing.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, they have to move away from that at some point, so I feel like if this report is true, if there's any truth to this, it's either to just bring the Wii games into the fold somehow, or to just, you know, use this in a very peripheral way. This can't be the focus of the console. For what it's worth, Arcade Girl, Emily Rogers, the well-known Nintendo insider, you know, she's had a few things to say about the NX recently. And one of the things she said was this article about the NX detachable controller supporting force feedback and motion controls has truth. So this is another source that confirms what Let's Play has heard. She also had this to say. The NX prototype had a 6.2-inch 720p multi-touch touchscreen. It's unknown if the final product screen will be larger, smaller than the prototype, and... you know, what eventually the final product will be, if it'll be a 720p screen, if what size it'll be, that kind of stuff. It'll be interesting to see. But it's encouraging to hear 720p, though. I mean, that's a good screen for a handheld of that size. The other thing she mentioned was the prototype for the dock station has USB ports, two USB ports is what she's heard. She doesn't know if the number will change in the final product. And she also mentioned that what we've heard about Game Freak being involved with the NX, the creators of Pokemon games, has some merit to it as well. So Pokemon could very well be rearing its head on the NX. Frankie, what do you think about that, though, man? About a 6.2-inch 720p multi-touch touchscreen. That's kind of what we want out of the NX portable part, right?
Yeah, I would say so. That's a decent-sized screen. 720p is, you know... for all intents and purposes, it's HD, so...
yeah. Especially on a screen that size. On a 6.2 inch screen, that's gonna be an incredible fidelity. The question I still have with this Bender though is, how does this translate to the big screen gaming? Like, we've got the 720p stuff on the screen there, but are we going to be able to dock this thing and then have it convert to 1080p properly on the big screen? I mean, there's still some questions about how that's all going to work, right?
Yeah, that's a possibility, I would think. Depending on what the docking station, if it had what its guts are made of. I mean, it could have some sort of thing that helps it to give it more processing power or up-res it or something. So I don't know about that, but that is a decent sized screen though. 6.2.
Because I was bigger than the Vita screen.
Yeah, because I was just like thinking of, I've got an iPhone 6S and it's a 5.5 inch screen. So for it to be almost an inch bigger than that, that's pretty big. That's a good size screen. Yeah. So I think that's pretty cool. But yeah, I don't know. I don't know about the 720 thing. If they'll be able to up-res it or anything or how that'll work. But I guess we'll have to wait and see.
Yeah, I feel like that's one of the predominant theories right now, is that docking station is going to give the system some more juice, so that when you put it in there, however it works, they're able to process things at a higher rate, and you'll be able to get a proper like big screen experience when you plug the NX into the dock. I'm really curious to see how all that works. Reggie had some things to say about the NX. He said Nintendo's got to do a better job communicating with its fans. I'll say so. Let's see what Reggie had to say. Quote, "One of the things that we have to do better when we launch the NX, we have to do a better job communicating the positioning for the product. We have to do a better job helping people to understand its uniqueness and what that means for the gameplay and experience. We have to do a better job from a software planning standpoint to have that continuous beat of great new games that are motivating more and more people to pick up the hardware and more people to pick up the software. Those are the critical lessons. You have to make sure people understand the concept. You have to make sure you've got a great library of games. And when you do that, you tend to do well. Nintendo has been in this video game business for over 30 years. We have a rich legacy of wonderful IP. Those are strengths that we have that our competitors don't. So leveraging those strengths as we drive our business forward is going to be critically important." Now, Frankie, that's all the stuff we want to hear from Nintendo, right? And that sounds like what Reggie should say. The question is, are they going to be able to deliver on this? Like, are they going to learn from their past mistakes? Are they going to deliver us a product with the NX that has a clear message? And is that message of, hey, you can take your games on the go, like, is that a clear enough message? Is that a strong enough message to get behind with the NX? What do you think, man?
It's going to, for me still, it's going to come back to still having to distance yourself from the Wii U. Because now if you're going to be out there talking about that, then you're going to have people saying, well, does that mean you could take that gamepad? Is that a thing? Can I just take the gamepad from that other Wii? You know what I mean? Like, there's a lot of things they're still going to have to kind of address that maybe the casual like market out there that still doesn't quite understand what the point of the Wii U is going to confuse with this now. Mm-hmm. So... either way, he's not wrong. All those things Nintendo needs to be better about. And, I mean, you know, we can hope that they've learned, but even still, like, they're allowing all this leaked crap to still float around on the internet and, you know, have people just scratching their heads at what exactly the NX is going to be. Like, I don't know. I feel like if it was Sony or Microsoft, like, they would have been like, all right, fine. You know, we really need to get out there and talk about this before people really start running away with some of these things they're hearing. So,
yeah, I mean,
I don't know.
They also wouldn't have announced an NX or hinted at it or talked about it a year before they're actually going to talk about it. I mean, people knew that a PlayStation 4 was coming eventually, but not once did Sony talk about the PlayStation 4. They sent out an invitation to an event back in February of 2013, and everybody knew at that time that was when the PlayStation 4 was going to be unveiled. Before that, we didn't know about it. So Nintendo's been talking about this thing forever, and they haven't discussed it yet, which is very odd. So let's hope that the message is clear with the NX. And speaking of unveiling the NX, you know, there was a report from Tom Phillips at Eurogamer, and he expects the Nintendo NX reveal to happen in September, like we heard, but to happen simultaneously via a Nintendo Erect.
What?
Freudian slip there. He expects the Nintendo NX reveal to happen in September via a simultaneous Nintendo Direct and a press event. So some type of like a exclusive press event for members of the press to happen simultaneously at the same time as the Direct. So I don't know. What do you think about that, Bender? Is that kind of the best of both worlds? Like, we'll get the Direct for everybody else to see, and then the press will be able to go hands-on with everything that they're talking about there at the same time?
That would be a cool idea. I hadn't even considered that. I think that'd be that'd probably be the best way for them to go, honestly.
Yeah.
I mean, because the Directs are really good for us at home because we get to see exactly what they want to show us. They get to explain it the way they want to explain it, and it's that you don't have to worry about things not working on a stage or whatever, and you know, people messing up their script or whatever. And then the press gets their hands on time, and they get to report on it and give us more detail about what they've experienced. So I think if they did it that way, that actually would be really, really cool.
Yeah. What do you think about that, Frank? I mean, personally, I like when companies go on stage and they do the live reveal and all that stuff, but this is probably the next best thing, right? To have a simultaneous Direct and press event, so you kind of get the best of both worlds.
Yeah. You know, like Bender said, having the Direct where they can kind of just go into all the nitty gritty that they're going to want to, you know, convey to, you know, people like us. And then, you know, that same day you got the press like, hey, you know, I played Luigi's Mansion on this thing. Here's how the controller works. Here's how all this stuff actually feels. Like, having all that stuff come out the same day, just the way that it probably would make the most sense for us to consume, I think that's the best route to go.
Yeah, no, I think that would be a good way to go, definitely. And let me ask you this too, Frankie. You know, we just alluded to it in the last story we talked about, but like how long is Nintendo going to wait to unveil this thing? And are they like missing their window? Like, are they waiting too long, or is just the fact that, you know, Nintendo's Nintendo, they can do this whenever they want, and they're still gonna draw, you know, a lot of attention from this? Like, we're now getting into the fall here, so we're going to have all the big titles coming out. We're going to have the Neo revealed here in a few weeks. We're going to have, you know, whatever's going on with Paris Games Week and the PlayStation Experience and you know, whatever else everybody's got planned for the fall. So they're now getting into this busy time of the year when they're going to be unveiling the NX, probably around a bunch of other stuff that's going on at the time that could possibly, you know, get into the news cycle and take some of the attention away from Nintendo. Like, when is too long to wait for this? Have they already waited too long, or it really doesn't matter because it's Nintendo and people are going to be excited to see what the NX is when it finally gets revealed?
Honestly, my concern is that they have definitely waited too long. You know, like I said, like, there's been, you know, they've mentioned it before. You've had all these different prototypes come out that people made in 3D printers. Like, you're past the point now where there's been enough people who've seen these things and already have like this impression of, oh, well, you know, I saw this as what this thing already is. Like, I think Nintendo needed to get out a long time ago and start talking about what this thing actually is versus all these random leaks, all these. And, you know, for all we know, the stuff that, you know, Eurogamer has reported on, maybe that doesn't end up even being the NX, you know? There's still that slim possibility. So,
yeah,
it is concerning to me that they have waited as long as they have, given, you know, the amount of people out there talking about it. So now you run the risk of finally going out and revealing your console and, you know, potentially disappointing people who may have by now built up different expectations for what it is. So I don't know. I do think that they should have definitely earlier this year, well before E3, they should have been out there talking about that thing.
Yeah. What do you think about that, Bender? I mean, have they just waited too long? I mean, they're going to be unveiling the system presumably after the Neo now at this point. So, you know, whatever Sony shows at their thing, you know, whether or not that gets gamers excited, we'll have to see. But they're going to be coming out after that's been unveiled. They're going to be in the middle of, like, the fall season when all these big titles are coming out. People are going to be talking about all the games that are coming out at this time. I mean, is this, like what are they doing here, man?
I kind of feel like, yeah, I kind of agree with Frankie that maybe they waited a little too long. I mean, the rumors for this thing have run more rampant than anything I've seen in a while. So, I mean, it's because they haven't given us any information to really, any solid information to go on off of, you know, to talk about. So people sometimes just make stuff up. But I mean, they've got it. I don't think they can wait any longer than September. I mean, it's coming out 6 months later, so yeah. They've got to reveal it soon. I mean, I don't know. I don't know what would happen if they didn't, but yeah, they have to. I think they have to reveal it in September at the latest.
I think that would be an optimal time for them too, because then you know, hey, our new system is coming out next spring, so you know, save up your Christmas money. Be ready for next year.
Is there any thought that maybe when they unveil the NX, it's going to affect 3DS and Wii U sales this holiday season?
I don't think anyone's planning on buying a Wii U this holiday season.
I think that's a valid point. But what about the 3DS?
I don't know.
I mean, is Pokemon enough to just get people to not care? And they're just like, the hell with it, I just want to play the new Pokemon game anyways.
It will for some people.
Yeah. Pokemon's still extremely popular.
Yeah.
There's also another Yo-Kai Watch. There's another one of those coming out, and that's apparently pretty popular as well.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, I don't know. I mean, I think if you're going to look at this, like, between the console and the handhelds, like, the 3DS, I think, is going to be the one that's going to be a little more resilient when this thing comes out. Like, you're still going to see 3DS games coming out a while after that. The Wii U, I'm pretty sure Nintendo is quietly just, you know, suffocating in a corner somewhere.
Yeah,
like, you're getting paper.
I don't even think it's quiet. I mean, they've been pretty upfront. Hey, this, we're not really doing anything with this machine anymore.
Yeah, they're holding the pillow over the Wii U's mouth and just saying, "Go to sleep."
We're still producing some until next year.
Yeah, some. Yeah, they're using air quotes and stuff. That's one of the other really interesting things about the NX, fellows, is how the handheld business goes from this point. Because we have to assume that this is going to be an expensive system. It's going to be at least more expensive than the 3DS, right? So they're taking this crowd, which they've had in the handheld market for a very long time, which is used to paying $200 or less for their platform, and now they're going to have to shell out however much this thing's going to cost, and it's going to be designed to play on their TV as well. Like, how do you think the NX affects the handheld first gamer, Bender? Yes, we can't really know until we know the price, right? I mean, that's going to be a big part of it.
Yeah, I think that will be a big deciding factor to see how many people want to jump into it on day one or wait for it. I mean, if you're a big 3DS fan or a Vita fan, you might not want to just throw that to the side right away. I think the launch lineup is going to have a big deciding factor as well. If there's a lot of games to play right off the bat, then that's definitely going to be something that's going to motivate people to want to jump in.
Yeah.
I think, too, like, that's a big selling point in itself. Like, when you're launching, you can sit there and essentially go, like, hey, you can play a console Zelda game on the go.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's going to be a big deal to a lot of people, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely.
Yeah. And, you know, one of the cool things, the coolest thing that's been touted about the NX is the fact that all of their developers will be developing for one system. Mm-hmm. So if you read between the lines, that means nobody's going to be making Wii U games anymore. Nobody's going to be making 3DS games anymore. So so they need to message that to their fans as well. Like, look, like, there are going to be no more Nintendo games for the 3DS. Like, this is it. Like, all of this stuff's going to be on the NX moving forward. So it's going to be interesting to see how the handheld crowd responds to this. Because even at $299 or $399, that's a pretty penny to swallow for a Nintendo handheld device that people have been buying for their kids and families for a long time for a much cheaper price. Mm-hmm. So that's going to be one of the interesting stories to follow, I think, with the reveal of the NX.
Mm-hmm.
A couple other Nintendo-related items here, guys. Eidos. Never thought about releasing Deus Ex on the NX. Well, I mean, I guess it makes sense since the NX is not even out yet. So Deus Ex is out right now. So maybe in the future when the system comes out, they'll think about bringing it over to the NX. I don't know what the impetus of this was or anything. What are you saying, Frankie?
The director's cut, when that was initially announced, it was a Wii U, it was a Wii U only thing.
Yeah, I remember.
They initially announced that as a PS3 or 360 game.
I remember, yeah.
So, I mean, maybe they had something Well, I obviously not because they're not thinking about releasing it, but maybe down the road, like, that'll come out and they'll find some cool way to implement the NX's strengths into Deus Ex.
Yeah. We'll see. And, yeah, this is one of the things where, yeah, they weren't thinking about it now, but we'll see what the future holds. Dragon Quest XI was officially confirmed for the NX. So at first it was announced for it, then it was kind of like, hey, it's not announced for it, now it's officially confirmed. The interesting thing about Dragon Quest XI is that the systems that it's coming out for, it's in development for the PS4, the NX, and the 3DS. So it's an interesting group of systems there, because we know where the PlayStation 4 is at in terms of its power. We don't know where the NX is going to fall in that, and then the 3DS is way down there. In terms of how that system works, so very strange mix of platforms there. That'll be interesting to see how that works.
Yeah.
and then, fellas, I don't know if you saw this, but Nintendo's got a big indie promotion. They're calling the Nindies Summer Jam to kind of close out the rest of 2016 here, and they've got some great titles in here. And this is something I'd like to see Nintendo do more, especially when we get into the NX here, or you know. Take advantage of some of the independent developers out there. Give them this type of a platform. But there's some stellar games in this lineup here. You know, we talked about Axiom Verge coming out this Thursday for the platform. Other games in the Summer Jam promotion include Jotun, Valhalla Edition, Noi 2 Love, Devotion, Severed, SteamWorld Heist, the Neo Future Pack for Fast Racing Neo is coming out, Zarvat, Dub Wars, Ectoplasma, Soul Axiom, Antipole DX, Rocket Fist, Shantae the Half Genie Hero coming out in October. Yes. Bender, so we finally have an idea when that game's coming out. Forma 8, Hollow Knight, Stardew Valley, World to the West. These are all planned for the Wii U for the rest of the year here as part of their independent promotion. On the 3DS side of things, we've got Noi 2 Love, Devolution, Gurumin, A Monstrous Adventure, Azure Striker Gunvolt 2. The game looks awesome. Mega Man fans, take note. Antipole DX, Punch Club, Forma 8 Severed, and Runbow Pocket. How about that, Bender?
Nice.
Coming to the 3DS as part of this indie promotion. So, I love this. Watch the trailers. These games look awesome. Bender, did you get a chance to watch this trailer at all? Any of these games stand out to you?
I haven't watched the trailer, but I mean, some of the games do stand out. I mean, Severed, I've heard that's really good. I've never never got a chance to play that because I don't have a Vita.
Yeah.
I know Drink it's on Box, mobile awesome. Now, but I'd rather play it on a console or a handheld or something. Mm-hmm. What else? Oh, of course, Shantae. I've been waiting on that game for a long time.
Yeah, this is the first time we've had any type of release window for that game, right? It's just the first time we've heard.
I think so.
I feel like
It has a September 27th release date on PlayStation 4 and Xbox One.
Really? Okay.
Yeah.
Hmm. Interesting. All right. And then I've heard a lot about Stardew Valley as well. Like,
it's
kind of like a Harvest Moon type of thing, and it really gets its hooks into you. So that might be something I want to check out. And of course, Runbow Pocket. Runbow's awesome. One of the best, one of my favorite original games on the Wii U that I think is really, really cool and well done and really fun. So to have that on a portable would be pretty cool as well.
Yeah, Frankie, anything on this list stand out to you?
Pretty much the same games that Bender mentioned.
Plus
SteamWorld Heist. I know it's available on PlayStation 4 right now, but that game actually looks really cool.
Yeah.
It's quite a departure from SteamWorld Dig, so it's more of a turn-based strategy game, which is an interesting way to take that series, but it seems like it works pretty well.
Nice. Yeah, it's a good-looking lineup, though, and like I said, this is what I want to see more from Nintendo as we move into the NX here. Is a better presence in the kind of downloadable game space, because you know, as we read the new releases every week, some of the eShop games are not the greatest. So, but this is a stellar lineup here. So, at the very least, for the rest of the year, Wii U and 3DS fans will have some good indie games to play on there.
Cool. Thanks for taking us through those. We got some season pass details here for a couple games here. First up, Deus Ex Mankind Divided. The season pass will include two story expansions and a bunch of weapons and credits to unlock some stuff. So the two story missions that are scheduled, System Rift, which will be coming this fall, and a criminal past, which is due early 2017. There's also extra items that are available right now if you purchase it. An assault pack and a tactical pack. Both sets are going to contain different skinned weapons, ammo. I guess there's special ammo for each weapon. I haven't started playing this yet, so I don't know how that works. And grenades. Four Praxis kits, which I'm assuming are like battle packs in Battlefield. I know you unlock them for finishing Deus Ex Go, but apparently that's only for PC or Xbox One. No PlayStation 4 ones or whatever, so... additionally, you also get 5,000 credits and 1,000 crafting parts. So, probably get a pretty good head start in the game if you pick up the season pass.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think if you buy all that stuff separately, it's like $5 more or whatever. So, you save a little bit of change as well.
Yeah. Hopefully, I know Brent's review is up on the site. Spoke very highly of it. Sounds like the story is actually pretty good. So, I don't know. I think that's usually what's going to sell me on a season pass. Personally, is more story, and if the story is good, you know, why not?
Yeah, and two story missions in here, so that's should be a sizable amount of content from that, I would assume.
Yeah. So Ben, we got an email actually, kind of pertaining to Deus Ex, from our good friend Peter.
Yeah.
What's he got to say?
Let's pull up Peter's email here. Peter says, "Hey guys, hi guys. I'm going to make it short for the Short Pause Podcast. Heyo." Okay. I had a thought and a related question. The question is, in the old and also in the new Deus Ex and any related stealth game, why is it a problem if the player specs his character the wrong way? Let's say he goes the stealth way and is now having trouble beating the bosses in the game because they rely on pure combat or shooting. That seems like it would make sense. Of course, it's hard for a nerd fighting with guns, katanas, and brute force. You never see people complain the other way around. A player specs for combat and brute force in a game, and now he can't go a certain way. He will maybe miss out on story because he can't spec check for the right information. Why is the first one a problem and the other one is not? So it was a little bit of a longer question, so complain about it. We will not complain, Peter. Thank you for writing in. And my final question. A lot of games have an option to spec for and choose a skill that lets you do a double takedown. Where's the skill for double defense? We never see that one. Also, I started playing games on my Commodore 64, so I'm around your age. Old. Peter Nielsen.
Ah.
Thanks, Peter. Glad to know you're old like us. So, obviously Brent couldn't be on the show. Brent's a big Deus Ex guy. The guy that would be best suited to answer this question. So Brent was kind enough to write in to answer your question, Peter, as a part of the show. Let's read what Brent had to say. Hey Peter, thanks for the question. The funny thing about Deus Ex Human Revolution was that it was heavily criticized for its boss battles during its initial launch. Simply because if you did build your character up for a more stealthy approach to the campaign, you were often at a disadvantage during those boss fights. This was disappointing because it's as if the game, which encourages you to play stealthy, punish you for doing so. That is why they released the director's cut with improved boss battles not long after, because they realized it contradicted the point of the game. In Mankind Divided, there are many options to go through stealthily and beat bosses simply by conversation. It rewards you for building up your character that way. Now mind you, I've only played through the campaign once, stealthily. I've just started my new game plus on PC, and I'm going to start building up Adam's more offensive augments and go through with a more direct confrontational approach. I don't plan to, quote-unquote, talk things over with the bosses. I'm hoping for a more action-oriented resolution that will reward me for building my character for just such a moment. It's funny that you ask why no one ever makes a stink about the other way around. It definitely had me thinking about it. I honestly believe that we don't hear anyone complaining about it that way is because there aren't too many action-focused first-person shooters that would want to break the pacing of their game for you to use your wits. Can you imagine a Call of Duty Advanced Warfare where you just blasted your way through thousands of enemies, one set piece after another, only to have it end with you and Kevin Spacey sitting on a park bench, trying to strike the right chord with him in an effort to talk him down? That's not nearly as enticing as dropping him from a 100-story burning inferno. I think games like Deus Ex, although critically acclaimed, are targeting a different type of gamer. the perspective from which you play is pretty much where the comparisons end with other first-person shooters. You're not rewarded with kill streaks and for mindless killing. You're rewarded for exploring, using your wits, and ranking up Adam to suit your preferred style of play. That's what makes Deus Ex so special in my mind. Your choices, your preference, and style of play will still result in a thrilling experience. So that's Brent's response. I think that was right on the head, nicely worded. I couldn't have said it better myself. So, Peter, there's a response directly from our resident Deus Ex fan. Thank you so much for writing in. We always appreciate hearing from you. Keep writing in. Use the Wave app. However you want to communicate with us. We love hearing from you, man. Thank you.
Moving on here. The Battlefield 1 Premium Pass was also announced. Surprise.
Yeah.
That'll be $50.
No.
Right? Shocking.
Shocking.
Typical fanfare. Going to get 4 expansion packs. Total 16 new maps. The first one will be coming in March 2017. Titled They Shall Not Pass. That one will make the French army playable. There will be a later expansion that will introduce the Russian army as well. In total, of course, 16 new maps. There will also be some new operations, new game modes, elite classes, and 20 new weapons and vehicles. Those who purchase the Premium Pass will also, of course, receive access to them 2 weeks early. And Premium Pass owners will also receive 14 Battlefield 1 Battle Packs, which, of course, you get new weapons, skins, and that'll be monthly, apparently, starting in November. That's pretty cool.
Yeah. Right on.
And, looks like you'll also get 14 unique dog tags, which will also be given out throughout the course of the Premium Pass's planned content releases.
So, it's not too shabby a package, then.
Yeah. So it's your typical fanfare for season pass, which is if you play a lot of the game, that's great. Yeah. Notice they've been giving away like the Battlefield 4 and the Hardline map packs.
I was actually just gonna mention that. That's one of the really cool things I thought that EA has been doing with Battlefield is they've given out the entirety of Battlefield 4 and Battlefield Hardline, the DLC for it, over the last few weeks leading up to Battlefield 1. I thought that was an awesome gesture. I downloaded them all, and I just appreciate it. I thought it was nice.
Yeah. More Battlefield news. Apparently there was a new UI change for the user interface for Battlefield 4. Apparently this interface will be unified across all the Battlefield games. I haven't fired up Battlefield 4, so I haven't actually seen this thing yet.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to do that. Fire that up, see what they've changed. So it's interesting that they went back and did that.
Yeah, I mean, I know Battlefield 4 kind of caught a second wind once they finally got that thing cleaned up enough.
Yeah.
So I feel bad because I remember when the Battlefield 3 beta or Battlefield 4 beta was out. You know, it was prior to the new consoles coming out, so I dabbled with it on the PS3. I had a good time with it. Like, it was a lot of fun.
I like Battlefield 4. I like it a lot.
Yeah, I just remember like getting home, and that was the first game I popped in, and it was just I didn't even think I ever got into a game, so I just never went back to it. I played a lot of Killzone Shadowfall, so
yeah, I played through the entire Battlefield 4 campaign, and did a lot with the online as well. Thought it was a great game. Still a fun game to fire up and play.
That's one thing I like about the Battlefield games. Like when I played the Hardline beta, like all the vehicles in there, like I just had a couple friends. We were just driving around the map trying to shoot people from the back with a shotgun. So that's one thing I enjoy about Battlefield, just the amount of dumb things you can do in that game.
Yeah.
Of course, at the expense of your kill-death ratio, but sometimes it's worth the sacrifice.
Yeah, definitely.
Of course, there's Battlefield news. There's Call of Duty news. Final DLC pack for Black Ops 3 will be releasing on September 6th for the PlayStation 4. Of course, that'll be coming there first. This one is called Salvation. This one will feature 4 new multiplayer maps and the conclusion of the Origin Zombie Adventure.
I want to play that, man. I don't know if you've been watching the trailers or whatever for that game, but the zombie saga in Black Ops 3 looked like it was pretty epic.
I haven't followed any of it at all. I haven't even heard Brent talking about it. I figured If anyone would be playing it, it'd be him, but
I don't think he's touched zombies. I haven't touched zombies. It's been a missed opportunity with Black Ops 3.
Apparently there's the trailer for it, the Revelations is up on YouTube, and Ben, do you check this thing out? This is worth pulling up somewhere.
Yeah, I mean it's a sweet trailer. It's epic. It's got Malcolm McDowell in there, which is awesome. Yeah, but it just this zombie saga here in Black Ops 3 just looks like it was crazy. Some of the stuff that they were doing. I mean, they've been fighting dragons and all kinds of stuff going on, and then it ends with this what looks to be just a bizarre thing with like the Earth getting invaded by creatures, and it just looks wild.
Moving on, here we got some Xbox news. The Witness will be coming to Xbox One sometime in September. Jonathan Blow and the team are targeting September 13th. Those of you wanting to play The Witness on Xbox, September is going to be your time.
Not too much longer to wait.
Yeah. Destiny was apparently free on the Xbox One. Was that a thing?
No, it was a big hubbub about nothing. The part of Destiny that was free was just the trial version on there. And it was just the way the store is being set up. See, I guess the original like vanilla Destiny was coming down off of PSN and Xbox Live, and people were thinking that it was getting replaced with this new free version. Why somebody thought Destiny would be going free to play, I'm not sure like what ever gave them that idea. The game, as we're going to talk about in a minute, still charts on the NPD 2 years after it came out. So Destiny will not be going free to play anytime soon, so you can get that out of your head. And I hope it doesn't, because I would hate Destiny to go free to play. But basically the item that's free on Xbox Live is the trial version of Destiny. You will need to upgrade to the collection if you want the full Destiny experience after that. It's basically what it comes down to.
The Destiny community is amazing. They've raised $500,000 for the St. Jude's, is it Children's Research?
Yeah, Children's Research Hospital.
That's amazing.
Yeah, over 1 week.
The Destiny community has always been one of the best communities out there, in my humble opinion, so that's awesome.
Hey, you see them doing a lot of this charity stuff, raising money for different causes, and Bungie will sell a shirt every now and then where the proceeds go to charity, but they do a lot of stuff with this that's really neat.
Moving on here, Halo 5, Forge, it's not DLC, it's just like the map editors coming to PC?
Yeah, it's like the map builders. So you can go on there, you can build maps, you can test your maps on PC, which is the big thing. So it's like all the mechanics of Halo are like in your PC version now. It's just they don't want to put their full foot in that pool yet. Like, you don't want to go full in to the PC. We're just kind of tinkering around with map stuff, but basically the framework is there to put Halo on the PC now.
Gotcha. And that'll be dropping on September 8th. As well as the Anvil's Legacy DLC. This will be coming to Halo 5 on the Xbox One. This is going to be adding a new arena map, a new Warzone map, Mercy and Temple, respectively. Of course, they'll come with new weapons and customization things from rec packs. The other thing that's going to be adding is a content browser to Halo 5 Guardians. So I don't know what that's going to be for specifically. I don't play enough Halo to know. So that's going to wrap up the Xbox bits here. So moving on here, Dark Souls 3, The Ashes of Ariandel, which is the first of the two DLC packs planned for the Dark Souls 3 Season Pass, will be coming on October 25th.
This trailer is freaking awesome.
It really is. So this is going to be adding new weapons, some new challenges, new armor.
I assume all the bosses they showed in the trailer were new bosses
for this update. New bosses, yeah.
And there was a lot of them in there. So this seems like this is going to be a sizable chunk of content here for $15.
Yeah. So just to give you an idea here, this is what the description here says. The Ashes of Ariandel will task players with exploring the secrets of why the new frozen land of Ariandel has fallen into its ruined state. Those of you who don't have the season pass, those will cost $14.99 on its own. So it's going to be highlighting a new area, which is going to help expand on the lore for those of you who get into the Dark Souls story. but that of course is going to come along with new enemies, challenges, weapons, armor, and new magic as well. So look forward to that on October 25th.
Did you ever go back to Dark Souls 3, Frankie?
No. I'm thinking maybe that'll be the game I try to tackle on my week off later next month.
Yeah.
But I get home from work and the last thing I want to do is stress myself out even more, so.
Yeah.
I still haven't hopped back in. I really want to, though. It's just finding the energy to want to play it.
I hear you, man. I always loved the way Dark Souls 3 and Bloodborne and all these games look. But then you sit down to play them, and you just gotta have a certain amount of patience and be in the mood to deal with one of those games.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. So I still haven't picked up the season pass either. I figure they seem to do these game of the year editions. So if anything, I'll just buy another copy of Dark Souls 3 next year. So whatever.
Gotcha.
Speaking of buying games, we finally got the NPD games list for July, and. Dude, this just gets more and more confusing every month.
Yeah.
So, some of these games don't have their digital sales, namely the Nintendo titles and Overwatch, because they don't track BattleNet sales. So, at the top of the list, of course, Grand Theft Auto V, because...
Of course.
I guess games don't come out in July anymore. But sitting at number two, and I have to believe, you know, if we were counting, you know, on that sales, that Overwatch would have overtaken it, but Overwatch sitting at number two, that's without BattleNet sales. Number three, Lego Star Wars The Force Awakens.
Holding strong here, 3 months
in. I assume that includes digital sales,
yeah,
maybe?
It does include digital sales.
Okay. Number four here, we got Monster Hunter Generations, which does not include digital sales.
That's correct.
Number five, Call of Duty Black Ops 3. That does include digital sales.
Mm-hmm.
Number six, Minecraft, which does not include digital sales.
Yeah, so where does that title fall with digital sales? Probably a few slots up at the very least.
God, that's insane that it's even sitting at number six without them.
Yeah, that's retail. And I tell you, man, you'd have to believe that retail sales for Minecraft are less than digital sales.
Oh, yeah.
I would assume.
Mm-hmm.
A majority of the audience is on PC. You know, there's a strong audience on consoles as well, but I'd imagine that a lot of the console gamers are just buying it right off Xbox Live or PSN.
Oh, yeah. So. Definitely. Number seven, NBA 2K16.
Mm-hmm.
Number eight, Doom, which does not include digital sales.
Doom continues to be on sale at a regular clip, and this chart shows that like people are taking advantage of those sales.
Oh, yeah. It's actually, I'm sure by the time... Well, no, it's not accurate. Sale actually ends on Wednesday, but GameStop currently has Doom for $20, brand new.
$20.
It's like, look, that game is awesome. So if you're interested at all in Doom, $20, go pick it up.
It's weird that the game, like, it seems like it's selling well, but it keeps going around, like, these ridiculous sales. Like, it's just like a fire sale on the game, almost.
Yeah.
Which is strange. I don't know, maybe I'm missing something there.
Personally, I think it's because they kind of want more people out there playing it, maybe kind of getting into the competitive multiplayer. Because there is the $40 season pass, which is more map packs, so I think maybe they want to try and grow that player base.
Yeah. Do people just continue to not talk about multiplayer in this game at all? Like, whether or not that's their strategy, like it doesn't seem to be working, because yeah. I literally don't hear a damn thing about Doom multiplayer from anybody. Nobody is playing Doom multiplayer.
No.
Like, everybody's talking about the story or the, mm-hmm. the single player campaign. That's it.
Yeah. Which is fine for me. It's great.
Yeah. But
as you alluded to, holding strong at number nine, still, Destiny the Taken King. This includes digital sales.
Yeah, and this has to be a game that continues to reap the benefits of being on sale. Destiny, another game that's on sale like every single week, it seems.
Mm-hmm.
On some type of digital storefront, so mm-hmm. it's impressive nonetheless. Though, I mean, The Taken King is essentially an expansion pack for a game that's now almost 3 years old.
Mm-hmm.
So that's pretty wild.
Rounding out the top 10 list here, Rainbow Six Siege. So I know that one had an Xbox Spotlight sale, and
mm-hmm.
I think they had like that free trial weekend, so a lot of people got to play it on Xbox for free. Probably went out and picked it up, so that probably helped boost that thing up there.
Yeah.
But that's great. That's a lot of those games on there are awesome, so it's cool to see some of those, you know, charting. Especially Destiny. Seeing mm-hmm. anything still hanging strong in there, that's yeah. awesome.
Yeah, it's good to know that people are still buying the game regularly, so that's bodes well for its future. Mm-hmm. But like you said though, man, MPD just kind of a disaster right now. I mean, you don't know which games are getting charted. You don't know which games are getting tracked. Like some games aren't even getting tracked. Like Sony published games, Microsoft published games, Nintendo published games. Like those aren't getting tracked digitally right now. So we don't have any sales for those. So only certain companies are having us track their games, and you know some games like the games are on sale, so that's going to affect the list now that you bring in digital titles. It's like we said, like Destiny's been on sale, but what about if Destiny wasn't on sale? You know, like it's like maybe we should have a chart that charts games that have been on sale for the week or that kind of stuff. I mean, that's maybe too crazy, but yeah, it's just a disaster right now. It's even more confusing than it was when it was just retail games. Now you've got some digital games, and it's a mess, man.
Yeah, especially things like Destiny, because if it's not tracking PSN sales, like is it tracking? Like, does Activision report based on digital sales?
Yeah, I think
and Xbox?
Activision does report. But if Destiny were published by Sony, you wouldn't chart the digital sales from it. So it's just weird, man.
Yeah, like you mentioned, bringing in like digital sales that are being tracked, like games like Rainbow Six Siege going on sale, you know, like and all of a sudden appearing out of nowhere. It kind of
skews the list a little bit.
I mean, it's nice having more data, but at the same time, just not having it consistent, just it doesn't paint a good picture, you know.
Yeah, when the digital stuff was originally rolled out, I was like, oh, this is cool. You know, we'll get an idea of the digital sales. This is a good first step. But, you know, now that we've been in it for a few months, maybe we should have just waited until everybody was all in on the digital tracking, because now it gives us a list that's skewed even worse than the list was before. And it's even tougher to kind of parse through the data and get any type of definitive answers on any of this stuff.
Moving on here, Respawn has responded to some of the harsh...
Responded?
Responded.
I like it.
Some of the probably overly harsh Titanfall 2 technical test feedback.
Boy, I tell you what, man, people were they were going no holds barred on Titanfall 2. They were some unhappy campers.
You know, they still are, and well, I just feel it's kind of in the maps for me personally. Like the maps are too campy, kind of promote people camping more, which. You know, it's a game about mobility and, you know, being able to get up to those people. But if you got two guys camping a spawn point, you know, from a rooftop, you're going to have a hard time getting up to them, you know?
But Now you've played the new map with this current test, right?
Super briefly. I didn't get to, like, run around and explore as much as I want to. Okay. So I got disconnected.
Yay. So I know one of the things they said was that this one was supposed to be more conducive to pilot mobility. From your brief experience, was that the case?
Yes.
Or? Okay.
Yes. Yeah, I actually kind of want to play that one. I want to try to get on sometime tomorrow and actually play a full match on that map. That'd be great. Mm-hmm. It does seem like that map is actually going to be a lot better than, you know, the other two we had last week.
Mm-hmm.
But so some of the things that they're going to be addressing, they're going to be tuning the airspeed and wall running speeds to be faster, because apparently people didn't feel like they were moving fast enough, which I don't know about you guys, but I felt like I was moving pretty fast trying to bounce around between walls and double jump to get to a rooftop. Like, I felt pretty quick to me.
Yeah, I mean, it's a little overwhelming, too, if you've never played Titanfall, to try to get your head around all of these movement abilities. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know. Yeah, I guess some of these veterans were like, yeah, dude, we need to be faster.
Especially if you pull the grapple into that, like, whatever. Players will once again accumulate and retain more speed when chaining wall runs. I was pretty sure you did that. That was like in that trial, the training
gauntlet,
course that you did.
The gauntlet thing, yeah.
Yeah, like that's they're telling you to do, so.
Mm-hmm.
Pilots will once again acquire a small passive amount of Titan meter every few seconds. Me personally, that's great because I'm not good at this game. And if you end up in a match, you're just kind of getting, you know, camped into a corner. you're probably not going to get a Titan, so.
Yeah, that was a big one there. A lot of people were up in arms over this, so good to see they're addressing this aspect of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Titan dashes will, when you actually get your Titan, the dash will recharge a lot faster. That's a thing that it's probably going to be more noticeable once you actually get to play the full game and experience the different Titans. Certain Titans are like have better mobility, so I assume that's something that I don't know why people are complaining about again. That was because in the first game, like that was varied. Like if you have a big tank Titan, he's not going to dash very fast. And I mean, it, like it didn't charge very fast because it wasn't like one of your primary things you were trying to do, like with the big Atlas Titan. So I read some of the stuff. I just think people like to complain personally, but.
Mm-hmm.
So talking a little bit more about their map design, they're trying to do like a little more of a variety in terms of maps, which so far has been pretty apparent in the beta. So there will be more maps, different varieties that'll kind of promote the idea of different strategies for, you know, getting around and taking out enemies. They're going to be bringing in the fade distance in for enemy outlines, so they don't reveal pilots at extreme distances. That's good. So that seems to be the main things here. I don't know. After playing it, like it felt like Titanfall to me. You know, first couple games, you just get your like ass handed to you. It's just not fun. You know, that's in any game. And I'm not gonna fault Titanfall for it alone, but look, any game you play and you're just getting steamrolled. You're not having fun regardless. So,
yeah, I think the main thing with this is that they're listening. If they're listening to feedback from the players. Like, these were some of the main complaints people had with just week one of a pre-alpha technical test, and they're taking this feedback to heart, and they are making these changes. So, yeah. If you're in this technical test and you're playing this game, like, your voice will be heard if you speak up and let Respawn know, like, how you feel about how the game's progressing. Like, they can implement these changes if you feel are necessary, you know?
Mm-hmm. So, you know, given all these changes into effect, I know you guys didn't dabble with the first Titanfall, what did you guys think when you played it? Like, are these changes make sense to you? Did you feel any of these are like problems as like newcomers to the game? Like, do these changes sound like they make sense to you? Like,
just from hearing from like all the people that played and enjoyed Titanfall 1, I mean, it seems like this stuff makes sense. I don't have enough experience with the franchise. Didn't play enough of the technical test last week to know whether or not like these are things that I would want to be implemented in the game. But stuff like, at the very least, the Titan meter increasing for people every few seconds, regardless of how your performance is, like, I think that's a good thing for the game. It'll help people that are more casual, people that aren't like the hardcore Titanfall players. It'll help them get into matches and have fun and get Titans and that kind of stuff as well. So I think that's a good change. But from what I've read from the feedback from people, like, this seems like these are good things to address for this game, you know? Just coming from a new player's perspective. But I'm interested to play more of Titanfall 2. I hope I can hop into the technical test sometime, maybe sometime tomorrow, and get a few more matches in with it and see how it's coming along. But it's a game I remain intrigued by, and it's still one of the games. Like this is one of the most interesting stories about the fall, is how Titanfall is going to perform come its late October release. So be watching that like a hawk. But... yeah, you know, I wasn't very good at Titanfall. I liked what we played, though. There's a lot of potential there. Just, just got to get better at the game. And the training mode. Like, there has to be a proper training mode in this game. The training mode in the beta is just the alpha is terrible. Mm-hmm. Just a waste of time. It's like, hey, this is how you shoot. This is how you jump. That's basically it. It'll show you how to use Titans. It'll show you how to use the grappling hook. It'll show you anything, man. It's just really a waste of time. So, hopefully there's a proper training mode in the actual Titanfall when it comes out, or at the very least the single player teaches you the game properly.
Yeah. If I'm recalling great, I think the first one had like after you got through the room, you learned the basics of like wall running and, you know, of course like guns and stuff. Like, they actually did have like a pretty good, you know, tutorial on your Titan and kind of introducing like these are your skills, like these are the meters to pay attention to. Mm-hmm. So Bender, what did you think coming into Titanfall 2? Do you have any like prior expectations coming in that maybe, you know, you feel like some of these changes are addressing?
I didn't notice any like glaring issues with the game. but I'm not like a huge PvP guy, so I mean, I don't know. I was kind of so-so on the experience just because I'm not very good and I was getting killed a lot. I went, if I do get into Titanfall, it's just going to be for the campaign. So, I mean, I'm sure the guys who play the game like religiously are going to notice those little minute things that they want to be up to be changed. But I didn't notice anything like that really bothered me about the game or anything.
Yeah. I think that's the one thing in there for me is like having that Titan meter refill faster, you know, because like you, yeah. I don't play a lot of PvP games. Like I don't have the time to dig into them like that, but making it more skill based, it does. Like the whole point of playing this game over a Call of Duty or a Battlefield is you get to fight in giant robots and it's cool, you know? So if you kind of limit that to the people who are out there camping and getting all these, you know, kills and like filling that meter up way quicker than you, like, it's not fun, like, going up against an entire team that already has Titans versus, you know, like, the three of us and whoever else that are, like, hey, this is, like, one of my first times playing this, so what's going on? You know, so.
I tell you what, too, man. Every time I stepped foot in a Titan, like, I just got destroyed, like, instantly.
Oh, yeah. Like,
there's a certain skill to those Titans as well. That's why I hope that gets addressed in some type of a better training way. But yeah, the minute I got into those Titans, man, there was either another Titan bearing down on me, or some guy was blowing me up with a rocket launcher. Like I sucked. This is basically what it was.
I'm looking forward to seeing the different varieties too. Like it seems like they have a lot more in there this time around. I think there were only three before. Now they're up to six or seven. So that's cool. So that's gonna do it for the news. Actually, we had one of you wonderful listeners check out the Wave app and. Herman in Oklahoma actually left us a message, so let's hear what Herman has to say.
Hey guys, my name is Herman from Oklahoma City, and I have two questions. My first one, is there any update on Kingdom Hearts 3 as far as a release date or any new features? And my second question is, what is your favorite series of games, such as the Batman series or Mass Effect or BioShock or anything like that?
Kingdom Hearts 3, I mean, they're still not really saying much about that, are they?
Yeah, from the latest information we have is pretty much that, you know, Final Fantasy 15 is on the front burner right now. So it's like kind of all hands on deck, getting that game prepared, getting that game out. I think once we see the release of Final Fantasy 15 in late November, you know, then we can start to ramp up towards Kingdom Hearts 3. But until that point, in fact, I think the director for Kingdom Hearts 3 is heavily involved in Final Fantasy 15, or they may be the same guy. I'm not 100% sure on that. Yeah, they may be the same director. So so basically Final Fantasy 15 has to get out of the way before we hear more about Kingdom Hearts 3. I mean at the earliest, I think Kingdom Hearts is a 2018 title at the very earliest. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you guys have read or heard else, but that would be my assumption.
Yeah, I mean, they've been really quiet about it. I know they're kind of talking more about that 2.8 thing they're doing, which I don't even know what that is. But
yeah, like the prologue to Kingdom Hearts 3, whatever. The very strangely named Kingdom Hearts 2.8 with some type of weird subtitle or whatever.
Yeah, so I don't know. But favorite franchise, Bender, I want to start with you on this one.
It's kind of tough to narrow it down. I my favorite franchise is probably Zelda. I love all the Legend of Zelda games. I played all of them. I beat all of them except for Zelda 2. but I mean, there's so many that I could also name. I mean, I love the Portal games. I wish there were more of those. Uncharted, obviously, is great. Mario, Metroid. You know, there's so many great franchises out there, but I think my favorite is Zelda of all time.
It's a good one. Ben?
This is an extremely tough one, man. It's almost like you have to go by like console. It's like this was my favorite franchise on this console, but then when I moved to this console, this was my favorite franchise on there. Mm-hmm. So it's very tough for me to narrow down a favorite franchise. I mean, like, this is going to sound weird because there's only one of these games, but there's going to be more of this game, and that's The Last of Us. But The Last of Us had such an impact on me just as a game. It was just, it's just such a phenomenal title that I can't wait to get back into that world and see what Naughty Dog does next with that franchise. Never has it has a game, and still hasn't to this point, reached the narrative heights of The Last of Us. It never has a game combined gameplay and performance and emotion and just story into one cohesive whole in quite the way that The Last of Us has. It's such a special title, and I just can't wait to see where they go from there with that franchise. So gun to head, if you're like, what's the best franchise right now? I'm going to say The Last of Us, even though there's only one game. But like, of all time, though, there's a lot of them on there for me. Like, Castlevania is one of those, Metal Gear Solid, Mario, Uncharted. You know, these are all franchises that I've loved over the years, and it's really hard to just pick one.
Mm-hmm. It really is.
Yeah.
For me, you know, like you, I initially started thinking, like, just in terms of console generations, like, I mean, the past couple, like, I initially was going to pick, like, Sly Cooper or Infamous, because I love those games, but, like, digging back to just, like, even what got me into gaming, I have to go with Mortal Kombat. Mortal Kombat was my very first gaming experience, you know, ripping people's head off as Sub-Zero, and, you know, when I got my own, my parents got me my own Genesis when I was in, like, second grade, you know, I got Mortal Kombat 2.
Baby's first Genesis?
Yeah.
Tearing out spines?
Tearing out spines. yeah, I mean, just Mortal Kombat 2, Mortal Kombat, Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3. I don't think I ever had, like, vanilla Mortal Kombat 3, but just over the years, like, there's always been, like, that constant. If I have a gaming console, I have Mortal Kombat. You know, even getting into the Dreamcast and N64, you know, Mortal Kombat 4 or Mortal Kombat Gold. Mm-hmm. You know, of course, you know, going through the PlayStation 2, GameCube, you know, Deadly Alliance, all those, you know, games, which are, they're okay. You know, they're just okay, but coming back now full circle, where Mortal Kombat is, again, one of the best fighting games on the market. Like, I, regardless of what generation of console I'm playing, I'm always, Mortal Kombat's a constant for me, so I'd definitely have to pick Mortal Kombat.
Don't forget that awesome Sub-Zero side-scrolling platformer.
What's wrong with Mythologies, Bender?
It was terrible.
Not as bad as Special Forces. Special Forces was bad.
Dude, isn't that what gave us Bo Rai Cho?
Probably. I so believe it. I never played it. Not interested.
At the very least, we have to thank you for that, right? Bo Rai?
I was pretty sure he came from Deadly Alliance. Like, I thought that was his first probably appearance. So.
He came from one of those games,
yeah. Yeah, it was Deadly Alliance. He's garbage.
Should we answer for Felsing? he loves Animal Crossing Amiibo Festival.
Yeah, Animal Crossing. That's Felsing's favorite. I thought he was into the Pokemon games, though.
Yeah, yeah.
I know he's probably pretty torn between those two.
What are those games where you shoot people?
Call of Duty Mario Mix.
Oh, yeah. That's his favorite.
Madden of Honor.
That was a good question, Herman.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks, we appreciate Herman. You taking the time to send us a message. So, but that's going to do it for us tonight, guys. Bender, where can we find you tweeting, playing games, living life?
You can find me living life on video game systems near you at me_Bender on PlayStation 4 and PlayStation 3. And on Nintendo consoles at Bender82 and Xbox Live at MeBender82, and also on Twitter, tweeting away at Bender_Guitar.
Ben?
As always, Franklin, I'll be not tweeting at Piccolo930. Of course, that's my PSN handle as well, so you can find me on there. And y'all come watch the Thursday Night Indie Spotlight, 10 p.m. Eastern. It'll be on our Twitch channel, twitch.tv/shortpauselive. Be playing the final station this week.
You can find me on Twitter, Xbox Live, PlayStation Network, at VyperStrike, VyperStrike. Probably also be streaming some Battleborn on Friday night, probably also on the Short Pause Twitch channel. But make sure you're following us on YouTube as well, youtube.com/users/theshortpause. Follow Bender too at Bender_Telecaster. Is there an underscore? Or is it just Bender Telecaster?
There's no underscore for that one.
No underscore.
It's just Bender Telecaster.
All right. Well, follow Bender as well. He tends to stream the Battleborn stream as well at youtube.com/users/BenderTelecaster. Make sure you're following us on Twitter at The Short Pause. Make sure you're subscribed to this podcast on iTunes, SoundCloud, or TuneIn Radio. If you like this podcast, go over to iTunes, give us a 5-star rating. If you don't, if you like we're at a 4.9, you know, come over to the website, www.shortpause.com. This podcast gets posted on there every single week, so just go in the comments section. You know, let us know your feedback. Let us know how you think of the show. If you have an Android device or an iPhone or an Apple device, download the Wave app, WAVVE, like Herman did, and leave us a message. If you have any questions about anything at all, we'd be happy to talk about it at the end of the show. If you don't want to leave us a voice message, shoot us an email, podcast@shortpause.com, like our friend Peter does. If you have any questions about anything you'd like us to talk about, again, send us an email there. That's going to do it for us tonight. There will not be a show next week due to the holiday, so if you don't see one pop up next week, don't fret. We'll be back the week after. Probably talking about the new PlayStation stuff, so.
Yeah. Be an exciting show.
Yeah, yeah. So you guys have a great Labor Day, and we will talk to you after that. Bye-bye!
Bye, guys.
Bye. Bye.